Hello, it's Patricia Steer, and this is our third edition of Flat Earth and Other Hot Potatoes. Thank you for joining, and I've enabled chat, I think. So feel free to jump on in, and I will attempt to check chat occasionally without losing track of talking to you at the same time. And hopefully the chat works. I believe I've enabled it. We'll find out in a couple of minutes. I'm very new to doing videos and setting up Google Hangouts, so please bear with me. I'm just trying to learn. I guess we all are. That's what the Flat Earth's all about. Well, you can see my guest on screen every once in a while when there's a little noise over there, and you probably recognize Mark Sargent. He joins me today, of course, Mark Sargent of Flat Earth Clues and his newer program called Strange World. Mark, thanks for being here.
Thank you very much for having me. I could not be more excited about being on this show right now.
All right, wonderful. All right, so right now you are no longer where you used to reside, and you're closer to your family at this point. Can you tell us where you are?
I am currently, most people know, I used to be in Boulder, Colorado up until actually a couple weeks ago, and currently I am on Whidbey, that's W-H-I-D-B-E-Y, Island, Washington, the South End more specifically. Between Freeland and Langley. And yeah, it's an island just south of the San Juans, really pretty place. It's kind of rainy out at the moment, but that's the Northwest for you. So that's where I am. Yeah.
Wonderful. I was born in Spokane, Washington, and only there for a year as a baby, but I've been to Seattle as an adult, and I really like the general vibe of the area. I like the West Coast in general a lot. Definitely do. So anyway, I'm in Houston, Texas, in case anybody wants to know. Not born here, not raised here. Been here about a year or so. Was here several years ago. Moved away, then moved back. Yeah, I'm a bit of a nomad. So anyway, well, we're here with Mark to talk about the Flat Earth, of course, and any other related subjects. And that means anything's really up for grabs, because we're all on the Flat Earth, and anything that happens on it is ripe for the plucking. The first question I want to ask you, Mark, and many people probably know the answer to some of these questions because they've watched your Strange World program, excuse me, listened to your Strange World program and watched slash listened to your Flat Earth Clues. But how did you first get into the Flat Earth? What were you doing immediately before? And then what caused you to, you know, to start investigating something like this, which many people consider to be kind of crazy?
Yeah, very crazy. I was into a lot of conspiracies, and I had been for years and years. I looked into just about every garden variety conspiracy you can think of, everything from JFK to Pearl Harbor to the World Trade Center to UFOs, you know, to Roswell. If you could think of it, I think I'd looked into it at one point or another. And then sometime last summer, in the middle of 2014, I got kind of turned on by a German guy, and some people know the story pretty well, that had made some videos on YouTube, and one of them was about how plane routes were really screwed up in the Southern Hemisphere. And I really didn't think much of it. I thought that was kind of curious, but then after that, I stumbled across the Matt Boylan story, you know, the one where he was sat down on the couch by his girlfriend and, you know, real straightforward the story about how he was a freelance artist working for NASA after he graduated from college out of Canada. And I thought, you know what? That's a really good story. I totally dig the story, but can I disprove it? You know, because like everybody, you know, like, you know, not necessarily you, because you're really weird and you kind of got onto this and really embraced it right away. But most people, again, they look at this story, you know, they look at the whole concept. When anyone says flat earth, enclosed world, Truman Show, whatever, people, they brace against it. And I did the same thing. And I'm really stubborn when it comes to a lot of stuff. Most people don't know that. They think, oh, no, he just latched on to flat earth and ran with it. No, I didn't like it at all. I thought it was, ridiculous, silly. I rolled my eyes, laughed at it. And I turned around and spent the next 9 months from the middle of last summer all the way to February this year, just hammering on it, trying to figure it out. And could not get, once I got to the point where there was this tipping point where I was going, okay, the ball earth, the globe, the sphere, that was losing. It started, you know, the tipping point was really going to the flat side. Notice, by the way, I'm using a flat earth frisbee.
Love
sent
it.
To me, sent to me by a fan. That's in UN blue, by the way, flat earth frisbee. Look it up online. I don't know what's the exact site where you can buy these things, but he sent me a bunch of them, so I'm throwing them around wherever I can. And anyway, I realized that the globe was losing, and So in February, I had that weird, again, that Jerry Maguire moment where I woke up and said, look, there's something to this. There's really something to this. It's coming across like a static your radio station, and I wanted to give it some clarity. So I came up with a very simple structure of narrative and slides, just a blending slide images, and wrote the narrative out as quick as I could, and then came up, the slides were all open source on the internet. It was not high production by any stretch. Used Windows Live Movie Maker. That's free, by the way, that comes with Windows, and put it together. And at the end of the first day, I had the introduction, threw it out there. I think it was, what, 15 minutes, not even 14 minutes long, because I didn't have the YouTube rights to put anything up bigger than 15 minutes. And that was it. After the first one, the next day, I did the second one and third one, and I really didn't know what I was going to put up. A British guy helped me, Lawrence Wright. He's doing speaking engagements out there, and he's using some of my stuff. He was the one that came up with Long Haul, the name for Long Haul. He gave me the initial data for that, and then I stopped around after the seventh one. I kind of slowed down for a while, did creative force eight. Came back and revisited the flights in the Southern Hemisphere on nine, and now and you and I've talked several times before this interview. I just released Clue 12, which was Realize, and just put that out a couple days ago. That's doing really well, and that's where I am now.
Well, thank you for letting us know that. But I do need to add that I had mentioned when we started that I had enabled chat, and I got a message just a moment ago from David Weiss, and he messaged me and said chat was not enabled. So
Ah.
he would like to maybe message me back and let me know what I need to do. I clicked chat and I see it says group chat, and I don't really know what else to do. Of course, I could look that up, and but that would, I'm in the middle of the show, so I don't know.
Well, no, it's okay. I mean, I can sort of help memorize in tech support. There's one other thing you have to do with chat, and that is you have there's like enable link for the
Yes,
chat.
I didn't see that here on my, I'm using
Ah,
a map, and I
because
didn't see
like
that.
you and I have the chat on our side, so I can actually type something to you in the
Yes,
chat box. But
and how do I make it available for everybody else?
the audience members, yeah, if David's listening, hey David, the I just sent him that Newsweek article, which we'll probably talk about sometime during this.
Cool. Yes, definitely.
But
So,
if David has an idea of how to enable the link thing, that'd be great, because I've never done Google Chats as myself.
if you've ever, just to explain to anybody, on a Google Hangout on the left-hand side of the screen that I'm looking at, there is a blue box that looks like a speech box. And you click on it, and it puts chat, click in the right-hand window, and then it says group chat. And that's all I thought I needed to do. I don't see anything where it says enable or disable. It just, that's all I can say. And so for those who are disappointed that there's no chat, it'll have to potentially be next show, unless maybe David Weiss or somebody else is able to explain to me how to
No
do it.
worries. No worries. It comes with time.
People were disappointed that I hadn't enabled chat before, and the reason why is because this sort of thing. But
Sure.
anyway, back to what we were talking about. I know you've been, involved in other, looking at other conspiracies in the past, and looking at other, just being interested in what's going on in the world. What about Hollow Earth? How do you see that whole thing, and how does that relate to Flat Earth? I mean, people have said that they both can exist at the same time. Oh, David Weiss just mentioned, and he said he didn't know, and not to worry. Thank you, David. I won't worry. Right, I will worry. But yeah, but back to the question mark.
Hollow Earth. I was a big Hollow Earth guy for a number of years, and to the point where I actually, oh God, must have been 10 years ago, took a road trip out to Mount Shasta, California, to look for Hollow Earth openings, because there was always this rumor that in the Mount Shasta area there were secret tunnels and caves, and that you might be able to access. I mean, the Hollow Earth is a great story. I love it. Does it conflict with the flat Earth model? No. No, it does not. Not at all. The true hollow earth people will say that you need a globe, and that the entire earth is hollowed out like the inside of a basketball or a balloon, and that there's this massive space, an internal sun, and it's like a Dyson sphere where the continents are laid out completely spherical on the inside. But You don't have to abandon all that for the flat earth model, not at all, because most people don't understand. We live, I mean, what you're looking at here, the flat earth model, is very similar to what it would actually be, because we only live, the human population that's on there right now lives only from sea level to about 5,000 feet. That's only about 1 mile. That's very, very thin band of altitude for people to live. That's 95% of our population. Yeah, we live in a wide, wide area, but it's a really thin, you know, it's like a very, very thin dinner plate. So to have a hollow earth with another civilization the inside, how hard is that? You need what? A couple miles of subterranean area. And, you know, you could spread out. You could have all sorts of different civilizations living underneath us. You know, seriously, less than 10,000 feet of worth of cavern, as far as depth goes, that's all you'd need. So no, hollow earth does not conflict with the flat earth model at all, in my opinion. I think they both, in fact, I believe they both exist at the same time, because I think there's mechanisms underneath this, the control systems that control everything from the geological processes, the lava flows, the underwater conveyor system, and maybe even helping with the jet stream up above. That all starts from down below.
You've actually been criticized for that. Many people are saying, what does he think? There's, some kind of like pipes down there and furnaces machines, and such.
Machines? Why not? Why not? It's what we would do. It's what we would do if we were building something like this ourselves. If we were going to build a giant terrarium, a giant planetarium, look what we do now. You know, we plumb the whole thing. We use air conditioning for the whole thing, electrical for the whole thing.
Sure. If you have a fish tank, you've got a water thing, water purifier thing in there. I mean, yeah.
So people have given me some grief because they say, well, you'd want to leave. The thing they can't get around is the magma systems. Because that's why I tried to explain. It's like, look, we can do molten metal. We can pump molten metal. It's on a much, much smaller scale. And they say, well, wouldn't you want to leave that to the natural process? And I go, well, you could, but why? Why would you do it? You don't want to risk something as valuable and as fragile as our civilization to a natural process. I mean, one supervolcano, it's game over.
But other volcanoes have gone off and people have died and property has been lost. So
on a much smaller scale. Yeah. Vesuvius, everyone knows what happened to that fun city. The loudest sound ever created and that we know of was Krakatoa when that volcano blew. Yeah. People have died from volcanoes. You're not supposed to live next. I know mountains are pretty, but if they're volcanic, you don't live next to them. It's a pretty good rule to follow. But has there been a mass extinction to us? No, there has not. Yes, have there been super volcanoes that have gone off in the past? Yeah, we weren't here to see them. So no, I say that you wouldn't leave nothing to a natural process.
Go ahead.
No, we're not going to do this.
Back and forth forever. Okay, so with what you're saying, we don't really need to worry about, I don't know, something big blowing. We don't really need to worry about super volcano.
Not accidentally, because the process, everything is part of the plan. Everything is part of the process. So if a super volcano goes off, whoever built this thing, they know full well when it's going. You know, they probably were the ones that flipped the switch. If you and I are talking about the Yosemite one that everybody's been kind of like, right, and granted, right. That is, yeah, the one from 2012, the movie where Woody Harrelson dies on at the top of that mountain when that thing goes off. I would not worry about any natural process. It changes all your disaster movies. It changes the aspect of it because it is not accidental at that point. It's not random. Nothing in this thing is random. Not by a long stretch. Not the saltwater content in the oceans. Not the ring of ice around the outside. Not the dome. Nothing. You do not spend this much time and resources and effort to leave something to chance. You just don't. We wouldn't do it. And anyone that's more advanced than us, they certainly wouldn't do it.
It would make sense. A creator or creators that made the flat Earth would not make it so that it could just spontaneously be destroyed.
No.
They want to be in control of when destruction would happen if they so see fit. That wouldn't mean that human beings might not be able to do certain things, but it would probably just wipe Earth off, but leave wipe off people and leave Earth ready to go for maybe new people.
I'll use your fish tank reference, and I may steal that for future things, which is, if you have a real, because fish tanks are expensive, and I knew guys that installed really, really high-end aquariums. If you had a really, really high-end fish tank, would you really risk something by the way, there might be a short in this part of the castle that could fry everybody. You really going to let that sit there? It's like, well, it may not blow. No, of course not. You've got too much time invested into it, too much money, too much resources. We're important in this whole thing. Our civilization is important. And I can't stress that enough. We are, for lack of a better word, taken care of very, very well. Yeah, we've got some natural disasters here and there, but they're not like out of the blue. I think a lot of the stuff that's been happening, especially with weather, is mostly bounce back. It's blowback, really, from what we've been doing to it. I think we've been, especially the United States government, you know who I'm talking to, what they're doing with HARP. I think that they can control the weather in localized areas, but as soon as they turn it off, the system tries to compensate for whatever they were doing, and that creates other problems other places. So,
like the hurricane that no one really spoke about that was headed toward New York on the day of 9/11.
Oh, very nice. Good one.
Katrina, for example, that hurricane was, I believe it was odd that it happened like it did. And I also believe that the way the levee in New Orleans broke, that flooded the poor part of town, was also something that was a conspiracy, not a conspiracy theory, more like a fact. So that's
And I know you were in Katrina.
Yeah, I was there. I was living there at the time, but nothing happened to me, and I didn't see a levee break near where I lived. 3 days later, when I left, I did see water start encroaching toward the downtown area, just on the ground.
Every time I watch the radar image of Katrina, and we've all seen it, every time I've watched the radar image of Katrina rolling into New Orleans, I just think guided missile.
Me too.
I'm looking at this thing going, who was steering that? Jeez, you couldn't even veer it off a little bit. It's like,
Some people think, though, that what you're saying about there being less, for lack of a better word, plumbing underneath the flat earth, and that the fact that the weather in some instances, like the hurricanes and other things, is being controlled, takes away things that are natural, and we're removing nature from the flat earth.
It's taking away some of the, for lack of a better word, some of the damaging properties of it. Something, you know, again, it's, if we don't notice that things aren't as random if we don't notice the randomness, you know, the lack of randomness, then it doesn't really matter. The jet stream, for example. Yeah, the jet stream up in the upper atmosphere, which controls all the weather patterns. If that is modified on a regular basis by whatever system this is to keep us from having weird, you know, because remember, if you go back only a certain number of years, we're talking an agricultural system where you've got crops are very, very important. You've got to keep that going. You don't want to have like two or three really, really bad years of crops where, you know, everything gets laid to waste. So you try to keep it as stable as possible. Now, of course, there are things that have happened in the past, you know, with nature. But I think overall, you know, that we've done pretty well, all things considered.
And California is supposedly, let's hope, coming out of the drought situation because they're predicting a very wet fall and winter, or winter generally. So hopefully that's going to happen. So things, when left to nature, is that nature making rain come back, or has that been geoengineered, or is it geoengineered that it was dry? I don't know.
Again, ever since we've had the ability, and we've had this for some time now, to modify the weather in various ways, not just, you know, seeding the clouds, but I think, you know, doing it with frequencies and, you know, again, whatever HARP's up to. I think the backlash from that, basically all bets are off when it comes to weather now. You know, the tornadoes that were in the South a few years back, they were ripping apart towns. Were those deliberate? You know, were those a test for something? There's some wonderful videos out there, but people showing that the radar, you know, the Doppler systems were showing these weird circular things just before it happened, you know, like they were toying with it. You know, using weather as a weapon has always been a neat little priority for the military. They've looked at this and it's like, because it seems so simple and you can't blame it on anybody. You know, it's like, if you can do not just weather, but earthquakes as well. So if you can create a tornado here, a hurricane here, a typhoon there, that delivers a massive amount of energy that can really decimate the morale of a military force.
I was living in Northern California, Modesto, which is pretty far away from San Francisco, during the Loma Prieta earthquake, the big earthquake. People probably heard about the biggest one in our lifetime. I felt it. I was in a radio station working, and we rushed out of the building, and I saw the parking lot of the radio station undulating, you know, like this. And it was, whoa, and it's the only, I lived in California for a long time, the only earthquake I ever felt. And it was in Modesto, quite far away. And when I went home to my house later, pictures were crooked on the wall. Things weren't smashed all over because I was far enough away. But you have to wonder about that. I mean, at the time, of course, I thought it was natural, and at any moment there could be an earthquake. But then I know there's been earthquakes in the far distant past in San Francisco, though. So I don't think that those were engineered, because it was, you know, quite a long time ago.
When I first heard the story about the earthquake in Haiti, the one that hit the Port-au-Prince, when I looked at the epicenter of that thing, it was so dead on. I was going, wow. I immediately thought that there was an operation was involved there, where it's like, okay, let's test our earthquake machine. Where should we test it? Oh, Haiti is a good choice. Let's go there. Because it was so dead on. It wasn't like it was a glancing blow off the shore. You know, it was square in the middle of that city. And it's like, and it's really in the middle of Port-au-Prince? That's what you're going to use?
But sometimes they do, if indeed it is true that they are directing these things like that hurricane and the one that hit New Orleans, they're targeting areas where there's a lot of poverty going on.
Yeah.
And if that's what they're doing. And it's almost like they view us as expendable, the powers that be.
Yeah, there's the question, and I've touched on several things that I've done over the years, the greater good. And that is, you know, what are you hoping to accomplish? Are you data mining? You know, when you do, you know, like you do a big earthquake or a big hurricane, you're generating a lot of data. You're looking at a lot of things. Remember, the authority they're working on multiple levels here. They're harvesting everything they can. Really no different from the Germans in World War II. You know, their big thing was data. You know, yeah, we're going to kill everybody that we don't like, but we're also going to do research while we're doing it. The authority works in the same way. It's like, look, you hit Haiti with an earthquake. Okay, how does a population with those sort of demographics and those the poor conditions, the buildings, you know, you look at the buildings beforehand, you look at the food, the food infrastructure, the water infrastructure, you monitor everything. And to a lesser degree, I think the Katrina was along those lines. Look how long it took for the National Guard to show up. I didn't think that was an accident for a second. They were watching and they were looking and they were saying, you know what? I'm sure they had operatives on the inside watching what happened at night, you know, with the nightmare, because the power outage and all the gangs running through the streets shooting each other, the looting process. In fact, the only beacon of hope, ironically enough, was the reporters that were flying around in helicopters, landing around, interviewing people. It's like, you know, what do you think about the National Guard not being here already? You know? It was
handled really incredibly poorly. And being that I was there, I left on day 3 and just drove out of there. I'm like, power's not coming back on. Yeah. Although I had no cell phone, I had no access to any news media. Power was out, no lights, no way to get gasoline because the gas pumps didn't work because they, you know, use electricity to work. Of course, being a form of a prepper, I had enough food, water, pet food, everything you could ever imagine. I gave some to the other people in my building who stayed. So that was good. There was no looting or anything near where I lived, but I did, before the hurricane came, took my car and parked it up in a 6-story building, quite high up, because I was thinking that there could be large amounts of standing water and didn't want my car to be flooded out. And so I had to go after the hurricane was over outside. Of course, I wanted to see what happened. And of course, no power, just walking outside, eerily empty city, because of course, most people had evacuated, most smart people, they say. But I walked to get my car, and it was kind of a walk, and I saw all the trees down, and walked through the French Quarter. I lived right outside the French Quarter, toward the CBD, Central Business District, if you know New Orleans at all. And I saw people smashing shops, people smashing daiquiri shops, which is an alcoholic kind of drink people have in New Orleans that looks like those sort of drinks that you find in fast food restaurants. It comes out of a pump, but it's alcohol mixed with a fruity flavor. People smashed those open. They were stealing the liquor. People were smashing open clothing stores, stealing things. Nobody was looting Brooks Brothers, though, which I thought was pretty funny. Nobody wanted any traditional clothing. But they ended up burning down Saks Fifth Avenue, or burning partially down Saks Fifth Avenue. Just strange. But I walked through all that. Nobody tried to do anything to me. And the people who were looting were just people that looked like you and looked like me and just looked like all of our friends. It wasn't criminals and gangs. It was just people who were very opportunistic. Yeah. And there was no police around, no guard around, no nothing around. And after several days, I saw nothing. But I did, after I left the city and moved to, for a little while, Austin, Texas, planning on going back because all of my stuff was back there locked up in my apartment when the coast was clear. I did, you know, while in Austin, I was able to watch the news, and that's when I was able to see what was really going on. And what was really going on was all these people that were more people who were economically deprived had been told to, if they couldn't evacuate the city, go to the Superdome. And the Superdome was filled with people. And that turned into a crazy panic riot scene with some people getting raped and murdered and just a huge disaster. Where was a presence of police there? Police stole cars from car dealerships, expensive cars. Yep. There was all sorts of chaos going on, and there was no control, no president, not that they do anything anyway, flying in on a helicopter immediately right after, on day one when the storm was over, to make some kind of speech. And there wasn't the National Guard helping people who hadn't prepared with food and water until sometime after. So it was really a sad case. And so it made me think that even I, if I were president, with no experience in any form of politics, would know you need to handle that situation. It's a disaster that happened in your country that you govern. And so the day when the hurricane stops blowing, you're on a special jet or plane or whatever it may be to head to that area and find some way to land somewhere on some small airport that wasn't torn up and go press the flesh of the people, your constituency, and show support. But of course, that didn't happen for quite some time. So that just shows me it was probably a created and staged event, which is really sad.
Yeah, yeah. And you know, again, they took their time in helping the population down there. And you know, I people give me some crap for putting myself in the government's shoes, you know, and thinking like they do. And it's like, look, that's part of what I do. You know, I can put myself in other people's shoes, but I would, you know. You want to find out, they had to find out what happens to a city like that. If a whole city is hit, because this was different from, remember, the Northridge earthquake out in California years prior. Yeah. This was different. This was a water natural base. You know, it was an earthquake. It was a hurricane. And they wanted to see what the city would do. And it didn't disappoint. It fell into the patterns that most of them did. And yeah, they took their time and they got grief for taking their time. But yeah, I totally saw what they were doing there.
Yeah, I definitely created. They were just testing, and they were using us as test subjects, which is pretty. Yep. Scary. Then we've got the earthquake in Japan in 2011, and the tsunami in 2004. Perhaps for different reasons, those were created. And then we see Fukushima and all of that. What is your take on what's going on there in Japan? I don't know how. I mean, of course, there's somewhat of a media blackout on that. We don't get much information. We have people in California saying that animals are dying and that plants are dying, and they're getting readings that say there's a high level of radiation. Then other people are saying that that's a scam and the whole Fukushima thing is really sort of semi a hoax.
No, not at all. You can go. There are a bunch of YouTube videos. It takes a little while to find them because they're not named very, very well. But there were, you know, several years ago, people that were living over there were doing rainwater tests, you know, and it was straight up no editing live video where they would say, okay, you know, here's the radiation, background radiation, let's go to where some rainwater fell. And it's like, you know, and they would do this all over the place. Several documentaries, they do not get a lot of press about how the city, you know, the main cities around it were evacuated. But what really caught my eye, there were some ads. I remember this. It was a little story about people, radiation workers. Basically, they were looking for people to go anywhere worldwide, because they were changing out stuff so quickly there, and it was so toxic. Remember, you can only spend, even with the full-blown suits, you can only spend minutes, you know, a certain number of minutes in places, and they were hiring people for huge amounts of money all over the world, but they weren't guaranteeing their safety. Basically, they're saying, look, you want to make a lot of money, you're going to have to sign some, you know, some agreement saying that you're not going to be able to come at us for anything. You know, and it's basically on you. You spend too much time in this building, it's, you know, it's on your head. And so, no, I don't believe it was a hoax. It was an interesting, I don't know if they even figured out that the tsunami would have done it. Maybe when they were aiming this thing, they didn't understand it was going to go that far north and take that plant out, because that plant went in big fashion. I mean, you know, even with the long distance cameras, we saw the explosions. It made Chernobyl seem like a relative cakewalk by comparison.
So when any authority, if indeed they do these sorts of things and direct hits on us, mm-hmm. does something, it's no guarantee that it's going to go right. It's no guarantee that it's going to bring about the destruction that they want. It could go way worse.
Oh, there's no guarantee. You know, how many ones you want me to choose? Everything has room for error. And, the Murphy's Law, if something can go wrong, it will go wrong. They try to cover as much as they can. If the operation is small enough, you know, like the Boston bombing or Sandy Hook thing, which were atrocious, or even as, you know, the reporter thing, that little thing that happened recently, it was embarrassing.
What was the worst one yet, I think, or the funniest one yet?
You know what, not to digress too much, you know what embarrassed me most about that? Because I watch these things, I just shake my head. It's like, learn production value, people. If you're going to do this, hire people that can at least get it right, at least get the consistency, so that the people from moviemistakes.com just don't start ripping it apart. The original video from the cameraman was bad enough, and then I find out a couple hours later that the shooter was using his own cell phone to also record it, and I'm watching his version and I'm going, why is nobody noticing? He's right behind them. There's nobody else on that deck except for them. And and then of course the smoking gun, which was, I thought was great, was, you know, they identified him because of the cliche dead cameraman's camera on the ground sideways is looking up and they can see his face, right? But you know, the internet forgets nothing, and they check everything frame by frame, and they went through that guy's camera frame by frame. There's going, it never looked up. You know, it's like the camera lays down sideways. It's never going to tilt up. All you're going to see is the guy's shoes. So, and it was supposedly clear enough to see him. It was ridiculous.
And now they're saying there's some, you know, he identified with a 9/11 hijacker. So they're tying this fake.
Are you serious?
I didn't even. Looks fake to hammer home the point that 9/11 was done by, you know, terrorists with box cutters and who hate our freedoms. So.
Yeah, and let's not forget the race angle.
The race angle too, yeah.
I mean, I I'm not picking, you know, I'm all God's children. I'm not judging. But, you know, giant black guy versus little blonde woman, you know. Really? That's what you're going to do?
They're pushing an agenda, and they keep on pushing it. And I don't think anybody's buying a race war.
No!
I don't think we're going to go for a race war. Sorry, why don't they stop pushing that?
Yeah, again, you and I have talked about this, where it's like, look, if it didn't happen in Charleston, if it didn't happen to Detroit or D.C., look, it's not going to happen. You know, I'll say it, if this isn't controversial. Look, unless there's an actual public lynching, you're never going to get something started there. It's never going to happen. You can have incidents
cool.
like this.
Too smart. Too yeah. people. I don't need people who hate other races, really. I mean, you see comments on the internet, but I don't go into the grocery store and have somebody say something derogatory about another race in front of me. And I know it exists. Racism exists. Sexism exists. All of these things exist. But I don't see, I mean, there's nobody out on my street right now with signs saying, you know, down with Caucasians or I hate black people. I mean, I just don't see our world as being like that here now. I could be naive, but I often think that these things, you know, like Ferguson, they're stirred up. They hire people to go there and hold signs and loot, and then of course the crowd, who's sort of innocent, just watching like it's TV, just starts diving in and jumping in on it.
Yeah, I think they were hoping that after the Rodney King thing, which seemed perfectly legitimate because it was just they were just the whole that whole process, they were just dumb. But after that, you know, you saw how much damage was done in so many cities. I mean, that thing cost billions of dollars. After that, they said, hey, maybe we can use this for something later. And of course, you know, we can carry this over to September, which is now, which is maybe they were at the very least hoping they could just increase the tension so that if something did happen in September nationally, that this they could just add this just adds fuel to the fire. So that people, you know, will fall into the racial profiling, and that is, if something really did bad, you know, start happening, then there'll be more division in the streets. It's like you see a, you know, group of black people, group of white people. Are they going to get along in a crisis situation? Maybe less now than hadn't they run those stories. So,
well, we have a black president. That really says a lot that people have opened their minds and come a long way. Although I don't participate in voting and think it's all.
You've never voted either?
No. No, that's not true. I did vote one time. I voted. Oh, okay. The first time I ever voted, I voted for Al Gore. Sorry.
That's fine. No, I've never voted.
Sorry, because I mean, I wanted to participate. This is before I learned as much as I know now. I wanted to participate in the voting process, and I didn't want Bush to win. And that's who I voted for. I just, you know, and ever since then, you know, I don't vote, and I don't recommend anybody vote.
I hear you. It's the Kang and Kodos argument from The Simpsons. And that is, well, I'll give you, real quick sidetrack on that, which is what I try to tell people. They say, you've never voted, you're un-American. I'm just going, okay, look, say you're a billionaire and you're going to donate to a political party. You're going to give like, say, $1 million. Which one are you going to give it to? Democrats or Republicans? And then people are humming high and saying, well, you know, if you have that much money, you're probably a Republican, you're probably going to Republican, but maybe you're big on different, you know, civil rights. And so you're going to go Democratic. I go, no, that's the wrong answer. You're going to give it to both parties. You're going to give them each $1 million because they don't care who you give the money to. Neither side is going to be offended that you gave. They, in fact, they're expecting it because that way you're covered. It's not like a horse race. Either way, you win. Because, and they're saying, what are you talking about? I was going, because if you give them that much money or more, 10 million, 100, it doesn't matter. You get to help dictate policy. You can work your way up the chain. Not that the president has any power whatsoever. I don't think any president's really had any power in this country since Eisenhower. And that's a whole other story for another time. But once you have that money, you have the influence. And they're saying, well, okay, what's your point? My point is, if these people have influence over policy, what influence do you have? You know, one vote. What are you going to do with it? I don't think you're going to do it. It's the illusion of choice. I know it's a cliche, but it's true. Yeah. It's like you're given the illusion because that way, either way, it's the Kang or Kodos argument. If you know, people who don't know that, look up Simpsons episode. It's really, really good. And that way, if something goes wrong, you can vote whoever it is out of office. It's the first rule of power that most people don't understand, which is the first rule of power is never put yourself at a point of risk of being overthrown, which means you have to be hidden. The most powerful people in the world, you will never hear of them. You do not know who they are because they cannot be public. That's the first rule. If you're that powerful, the last thing you want to do is give up power, which means you can't give the public a target. You give the public all sorts of targets. You give them kings, you give them presidents, you give them monarchs, you give them dictators. You do not, those guys, they're just puppets. That's all they are. And you can say the Bilderbergs or the Rothschilds, but even they, I think there's levels even higher than those guys, names that we don't know of.
Yeah, I agree. People are always blaming everything on the Rothschilds. And it's like, well, they're complicit. They do have a degree of power, but there's somebody controlling them, and we'll never know who that is. So, definitely. Let's go back to the flat Earth. Isn't that what we were talking about?
Flat Earth.
This is all flat Earth related, by the way.
Oh, we can again.
No, it really is, because we all live here. So, that's what it's all about. And by the way, if you're just joining us, my name is Patricia Steer. Mark Sargent of Flat Earth Clues and Strange World is here with me. And Flat Earth and Other Hot Potatoes number 3 is the video that you are watching, or the live show you're watching, depending upon how you're viewing this. And I did want to enable chat, but somehow it's not able to be enabled. So I'm going to have to figure that out.
Well, it wouldn't have mattered because you wouldn't have been watching it anyway. So.
Yeah, but I would like people to be able to chat with other people. I attempted to enable it. It says it's enabled, but I have been informed that it's not. So please forgive me. And learning curve going on right here, right now. And I can't do anything about it because we're on the air. So I need an assistant. Anyway, back to the Flat Earth, and let's talk a little bit about Admiral Byrd. I've seen videos in your Flat Earth Clues, and I've also done some of my own looking at different videos of Admiral Byrd speaking. Tell us about Admiral Byrd, but first, you know, Admiral Byrd doing a TV engagement speaking about his exploration and expeditions potentially could have been controlled and lying about things too. What do you think?
Potentially, yes. And again, it's a weird that if you're talking about the video, you know, the one that's out there, he's only got really one. Right. From 1954, a CBS affiliate that was doing the Longines. I have to pronounce it right. Longines, not Longines. Longines. The because somebody, people have actually, that were old enough to watch that show, actually wrote me and said, it's Longines, not Longines. Get it right. It's like, dude, it was 1954. Come on. So when he was on the Longines chronoscope, that whoever released it, because remember, nobody had VCRs or anything like that. Somebody had to dig that up out of the station and release that now. In fact, I don't think that video is even a couple years old on YouTube, which was weird. It's like, who would dig that thing up? Where did you find that? And then convert it and then put it up on YouTube. Could that have been controlled? Maybe, but it went against everything that I know about the authority and how they work, which is, look, if you're trying not to talk about something, you don't talk about something. You don't have your point guy go on national television. Remember, there's only three television stations in the whole country at that point. You know, PBS, I don't think even existed in 1954. He comes on during prime time, and he's a national hero on that. He might as well have been Charles Lindbergh. You know, he comes on, he goes, oh yeah, Antarctica's made out of money. We ought to all go down there and make money. You know, and you know, he's listing it off. There's oil, there's minerals, there's a whole mountain range made out of coal. He's going on and on. You know, that's the last thing you'd want to do if you're trying to avoid attention to this outer rim. You do not let this guy go out there and talk about that. And again, like you said, things go wrong even in the best operations, because I think at that point they still hadn't found it. They're going, well, maybe the maps are wrong. Maybe they didn't know. And so they send him down. You know, that's Murphy's Law for you. He goes on television. He says, let's just make a lot of money. And then the very next year, they find it. And at that point, nobody talks about anything. There's no retraction. He doesn't come on. You know, they could have put him on television again and said, oh, by the way, there's something really dangerous down there, a dangerous plant, a dangerous microorganism. Nobody should ever go down there ever again. You know, they could have done that, but no, they couldn't even come up with a cover story. You know, like a dangerous meteorite had fallen. There's radioactive material everywhere. No one should ever go there. No cover story at all. They just all left, all the nations at the same time. If it was just America, yeah, maybe I'd buy it, but Soviet Union, Great Britain, they were rebuilding from World War II. They needed everything they could get. Everybody needed resources. Argentina was down there, New Zealand, Chile, Australia. All these nations were down there, and these were just the early guys. Everyone was, you know, they would have parceled that thing out to death if they had the chance. When they all leave unilaterally, it's screams cover up, the biggest cover up, because the two things. One, what conspiracy is bigger than money? Because money is our God and savior. You know, people have done documentaries on this. You can talk all you want about different churches and oil and everything, but we still worship, the industrialized nations worship money. This conspiracy was bigger than that, and they didn't come up with a cover story. That's the best part. It's kind of like the not having a cover story for the pyramids. Like the pharaohs never said, you know, they said, oh yeah, we build it in 30 years. Well, how'd you build it? And they just trailed off. Nobody ever, you know, there's not a single hieroglyph anywhere about how the pyramids were built. Antarctica, same sort of category, which is everybody leaves, they seal it off, and then they just don't talk about it anymore. It drove me insane as I was staring at this, because it's like, that's brilliant. You're just gonna shut it down, which is why the Admiral Byrd thing really was the most damning thing you wonder if whoever released it even knew what he was doing when he put it out there. Or if you believe in Providence, maybe it was meant to be. Maybe the Flat Earth movement was meant to see it, because a lot of people, it convinced a lot of people. when you have your the lead guy come out there in clay, you know, and the image was so good. It wasn't like it was really blurry and grainy, and there was all sorts of real chops in the video that was released. It was really high end for 54, and he comes on there and says, "Oh yeah, it's made out of money," and then all of a sudden, nobody wants to make any money. Come on. That never happened.
He was a naval officer, so some people have had some suspicions that he was sort of government-controlled sort of thing.
It's no secret. He was, he was military all the way, and he was a Mason. You can look it up on Wikipedia. Big-time Mason, and he would be, because they would have recruited him, you know, for this. And, you know, did the Masons have something to do with the cover-up? Of course they did. I've said this on several things. I'll say it now. They knew. They knew full well what was going on there. It is one of their biggest secrets that they keep.
Well, he is he was a hollow earther. I mean, he's not a, people think, well, he was a flat earther. Not really, but he has a lot to do with the flat earth today. But at the time, he was a hollow earther, and he felt he had gone into the underground, I guess you could say. But well, explain that to us.
Yeah. That's how I found him. I never thought, in fact, hadn't I been a hollow earth guy, again, if you believe in Providence, hadn't I been a hollow earth guy, I wouldn't have found his later work, because I initially looked, it was just a kind of a side thing. It's like, oh yeah, Admiral Byrd, hollow earth. I think I'll just go down that path. Just went down there. It's like, yeah, here we are in 1926. He supposedly goes in the North Pole, finds an entrance, you know, the North Pole in the center of this thing, and goes in and does that journey to the center of the earth. Scenario where there's there's a whole tropical ecosystem, and then there's a civilization in there, civilization of giants, you know, the rulers, you know, people, Nephilim, if you want to call them, you know, that's no accident there, you know, giants that run the world, the king of the earth, the whole nine yards. And but for some reason he leaves. After that, it was like from 1926, I think that point, whoever was running, you know, the secret societies realized, like, okay, if the hollow earth is real, then the outer edge must be real. So let's find the outer edge. Found the top. That was a cakewalk. Did that in 1926 with a crappy biplane. Let's see what we can do in the outer edge. And so for 30 years, he's flying out there. And after Jeffrey Grupp was talking about the thing that seals us, you know, the dome that's on top of us, is much, much bigger, which means there the gap, you know, the part where Antarctica starts before you get to, you know, to the edge, is way, way bigger, which could explain why it took 30 years for him to figure out where it was. But once they found it, where was I going with this? I completely lost my train of thought. The point was
Hollow Earth.
Yeah, Hollow Earth. That's where he started, but he never went back. Everything from 1928 till his death in 1957, again, look into that if you want to, you know, he died in his sleep, supposedly, at the age, ripe old age of, what, 62, 63 or something like that. Look, he was as fit as they could get. He led expeditions. He was career military. He knew what, you know, how to keep himself. And he flew his own planes. He was the point guy. Did he die of natural causes? Maybe. Or maybe he had enough integrity and he liked doing interviews. He was very comfortable on camera that they said, you know, maybe it was one of those things. It was one of those boardroom votes where it's like, okay, you know, maybe 5-4, or where it's like, you know, do we keep him? You know, do we just threaten him or do we kill him? Yeah, you don't know. Another hollow earth thing, though, I got to mention. People want to look up some interesting stuff. Look up Charles Lindbergh. Charles Lindbergh, also big pilot, knew the Admiral Byrd story, and he said, "You know what? I'm going to go up there." The rumor, myth, legend, whatever you want to say, is that he went up there too, and flew in with his wife. She took pictures, supposedly. And they came back to the States, and he was so pumped up about it, he went straight to the government and, you know, the Washington, D.C. and said, "Look at all these pictures. We got to run something in Life magazine, blah, blah, blah." And, you know, then the story goes that that's how the whole Lindbergh baby thing happened. Was it's like, look, you got to shut up about this. This is a big deal. He's going, "I'm not going to shut up about this." And people don't remember that Lindbergh left the United States. Never came back. You know, he renounced his citizenship here, even though he was an American hero. And it was, it's like he ran into a series of bad luck. You know, after the Lindbergh baby thing, you would have thought, you know, people would have come together and embraced him even more. But no, he bugged out. He left. And people, you got to ask yourself why.
Well, Bird didn't go on these expeditions by himself, obviously. He was the leader and flew his own plane, as you said, but there were others involved. So how people are always saying about all the conspiracies, you know, including, you know, moon hoax, that all of those people couldn't be involved and have kept the secret for all of these years. So what about the people that were with Bird on his expedition? Any word on any of them?
No, of course not. Any of the planes that would have found, that would have done anything during Operation Deep Freeze, which ran from 1955 to 1956 down in Antarctica, those crews, he would have picked his own crews. You know, he was the admiral, so he got to pick all his pilots and navigators, and he probably would have taken multiple planes. And it's very possible that, you know, that they would have been running parallels with Russia, because Russia was the other big, big country that was down there. And Russia could have been looking for it as well. But once you find it, because, yeah, you know, this, like what you were saying, it's like, how can you keep that many people a secret? And I'm not going to use the atomic weapons program of the United States, because that's, you know, a lot of the conspiracy guys will bring that. It's like, look, nobody knew about the atomic bomb, and they had 100,000 people working on it, and all those people kept a secret. You know, yeah, you can scare a lot of people. But for something like this, if you want the perfect example of need to know, it's this. You keep it at an absolute bare minimum, because you, mostly from the psychological standpoint, you don't want, because this wrecks people. Especially if they have to keep the secret. If anyone has any doubts, look at the Apollo astronauts. They decided, my opinion, that they told them, yes, you're faking it. Here's why you're faking it. And they show them this, or they showed them the pictures or whatever. But once that sunk in, they're like, because that hits you two ways. One, you have to keep the secret. There's a guilt thing coming up. And then you got to realize, it's like, holy smokes, you know, the world isn't what we think it is. There's several reasons why you don't tell people. And if you compartmentalize it well enough from a military standpoint, you could do it. You know, no different than the ISS people. You tell them, it's like, look, you're faking this and you do not have clearance to know why. All you know is you're faking this. That keeps them, you can't confess to anything if you don't know anything.
Right.
See what I mean? Yes. So at the highest levels, yeah, there's people that know. How many people? Not that many. How many people, I'll give you the NASA example. How many of those engineers do you have to tell? You don't have to tell any of the engineers. You don't have to tell, yeah, you might have to tell somebody that's helping create the fake telemetry data, which they eventually lost anyway. You might have to tell some people, but through eventual natural attrition, because people die off, you don't have to worry about too much. You also, you know, you use surveillance, and I know I totally sound like an agent when I'm talking like this. You tap everybody's phone lines, you tap all their emails, you make sure you keep an eye on everybody you need to, that in just in case, they swear and they sign, they say, I'm not gonna tell anybody. But then, you know, you still got to watch them, because you're not positive. You know, some of them, you know, they get married, they get divorced, they have kids, they have grandkids, they get weird feelings. You don't know what's going to happen to them. Charles Lindbergh, a perfect example. So you keep it as small as possible. Again, everyone has doubts. Look up how many people, and most of this is tied to Planet X and Nibiru right now, but look how many astronomers and radio telescope operators have died in the last 20 years. Yes. And I used to believe that it was tied to Planet X, because, you know, they're saying, oh, they all saw Planet X and they were talking about it in emails, and that's when they get clipped. And now I'm thinking, no, it's probably something way simpler than that, that all of a sudden they're looking at they're looking at the ceiling, basically, and the numbers aren't adding up. They're seeing some sort of structure. They're going, you know, the only reason way this math adds up is if we're freaking inside a giant planetarium, right? And as soon as they type that in an email, they're flagged. You know, look at some of the weird deaths that have happened with astronomers and astrophysicists and radio tells. There was an entire French, I think it was French, radio telescope team. I mean, like 12, 14 guys that died in a freak gondola accident. That doesn't happen, right? Outside of a James Bond movie, nobody dies in a gondola accident. And the whole thing just came crashing down and nobody lived. Don't tell me that it's, oh yeah, by the way, they were radio telescope operators. Don't tell me that.
Well, you know, it's unrelated really to what we're talking about with the Admiral Byrd and the ice wall and Hollow Earth, but a lot of holistic doctors have suddenly started dying. That might be somewhat similar in that they know something about diseases, how to cure them without using the pharmaceutical industry or that sort of thing. And of course, a lot of bankers had recently jumped out of buildings, had crazy deaths in which they stabbed themselves 20 times. I mean, I'm only making that up, but something really weird and close to that. And that might be part of the upcoming and currently happening stock market debacle and economic crash potentially that could be happening. Yeah. Maybe they know something, knew something, were told something. Deaths of people like that, you know, young and in their prime, or weird, strange deaths like the gondola thing you're speaking of. They occasionally, perhaps something weird could happen. It can happen to anybody. But when there's enough of them, you have to say, you know, it's not a conspiracy theory. It's something's going on here, definitely. Yeah.
And if they're high profile enough, I'll use the finance one for you, because bankers, if they're high profile enough, they just get pushed out. You know, they get pushed into obscurity. I will quote the Dylan Radigan story, if you know about that one. Look up that one, Dylan Radigan, R-A-T-R-A-I-G-A-N, where he was worked for MSNBC and, you know, did a lot of the financial stuff. And he realized, he was fairly sharp, and he saw the trends in the markets, and he saw what was going on, and he went off on a freaking tear on, you know, on live television. It's out there on YouTube. You can watch it. Watch the Dylan Radigan rant. And it is striking. He basically sunk his career right then and there. He said, look, for lack of, and it really sets up what's happening now. He goes, look, the United States is being extracted. We're being hollowed out from the inside financially. Everything is being cored out. And the only thing that's standing is going to be a skeleton. And basically, they're leaving us open to be the linchpin to where when they, like a giant game of Jenga, where they pull the United States financial thing out, there's nothing left of it anyway. I mean, people think, oh, yeah, the stock market's, and even there was a dip today. The stock market's like at 18,000. I mean, there's nothing there. I watched the crash happen. I was tied to that stuff back in 2009 when it happened. Look, you don't go down from 16,000 down to 8. And then bounce back all just miraculously, you know, within a few months. That doesn't happen. They were just pumping money into the bond system. It's artificial. But what I was getting at was that Dylan put himself out there. He said, look, and now he's an organic farmer, I think, out in California. He's done. He's out of the biz entirely. And I don't even know if he does interviews really talking about what's going on now. But I was inspired watching him. It's like, yeah, you know. He put it out there. And I know it's easy for me to say, you know, people said, you know, would you sacrifice your career to get your point across? He did.
There are very few people that do that. Very few people brave enough to do that, especially when they're in a field where they're making a lot of money. Yeah. And the fact that he went to do something like doing an organic farm shows that he knows really what's going on. And the only way, if any of the bad things that are forecast to happen, the only way to survive, depending upon what the event is to live a fully sustainable life in a remote location. I mean, and then even then, it's, you know, growing your own food, like perhaps maybe he is. That's the way to go. That's the ideal. Am I doing it? No. Are you doing it? I don't know, but probably not. We need to work on it. We all probably need to work on that. But back to Admiral Byrd. Yes. So he found, he said, the Hollow Earth, and it was warm, and there were plants growing there in the middle of the icy area. But what about the, people call it the edge, the edge, the ice wall, or whatever it may be. Is there anything in any of his writings where he said he found it, he touched it?
No, couldn't be. Because it, well, no, the world would be a very, very different place, and it would have been much earlier had he mentioned it. In fact, the Hollow Earth thing was really more from his own personal journal. And I'm wondering if even that part of that was a plant just to keep people away from looking at the outer edge by, you know, saying that it may be embellishing a little bit on the Hollow Earth, but I still like the Hollow Earth theory. Don't get me wrong. I think I love it, but having that, you know, because they had full control over what was going on with his life. They were watching him like a hawk. So somebody slipping out his journal and letting that story get out there for years and years and years, yeah, it might be true, but it may not be true. Because, you know, as like, if you want to do misdirection, the greatest misdirection is make sure it's the farthest point away from where you actually want them to look. So North Pole, outer edge. Did he say that there was an outer edge? No, of course not. Couldn't, you know, even if he wanted to, you know, maybe he did want to talk about it. He couldn't. Is it a physical hard outer edge that somebody can touch? Or is it what we call in the game industry, a soft edge, where you're going forward in the game industry? What you do is you don't, there's not actually a physical, you can see the edge, but you can't ever reach it because you're getting pushed back, for lack of a better term, like a lateral form of gravity. So you're being, you can't get there. Your arms are moving, your legs are moving. Let's say you're not even in a vehicle, but you're standing, you're looking down and you're not actually moving forward. You could put a rock next to you and you just keep, you know, keep doing this. That rock's still there right next to you. You're basically, you can't reach it because it's being forced out. You're being pushed back, for lack of a better term, from the other side. So
when people want to, oftentimes when they don't like the whole flat earth thing, there's plenty of those. One of the things they will say is, what do you think? There's an ice wall. I've heard that about flat earth. Why don't you, one of you guys, just go out there and prove it to us?
Well, okay. The ice wall, and people keep they keep screwing up the difference between the actual edge, the coastline of Antarctica, and what we consider to be the... Okay. You okay?
You're breaking up.
yeah, you were breaking it up too for a second there. That's okay. Because I'll start over. So the difference between, there's a big difference between, let me define Antarctica for you, okay? The ice wall that people are talking about is the coastline of Antarctica, which is, yes, if you go to any part of Antarctica, no matter where you go, it's about 200 feet straight up of ice. It's sort of like the one in Game of Thrones, that big ice wall in the north. But from there, then it starts ramping up. So it's 200 feet, you know, straight up, you know, from the water roughly. And then it starts climbing really, really fast to where it's about 10,000 feet and it plateaus. Again, it's a very, very unique continent to where it's 10,000 feet high of just plateau of nothing. So that is technically also be considered part of the ice wall, although you've already climbed up to the plateau of it anyway. So you're really on top of whatever this ice wall is. And then that goes on for a very, very long time. Yeah, there's some mountains that stretch up to 20,000 feet and all, but it is fantastic negative reinforcement. When you get out to the edge, is the edge made out of ice? Is the whole thing made out of ice? Maybe. I mean, there's been all sorts of alternatives of what this thing could be. Is it a force field? Is it a frequency barrier? Is it a heavy element? Is it heavy water? Is it actual physical ice? Some people have said, oh, it's glass. Really? What kind of glass? What would that glass be made out of? What we do know is that the United States government and the Soviet Union back in the 50s for four straight years started firing stuff at it, the biggest explosives they had. Doesn't matter if atomic weapons are real or not. They put really big bombs on the top of rockets and started firing them straight up, you know, everywhere.
Well, they called it nuclear testing. That's their cover story. So that's what they did, nuclear testing.
Yeah, and again, that's what men, and I'm not picking on men just because my host here is a lovely woman, but that's what men would do. You know, if they see something, it's like, oh, a wall. Hey, think we could punch through it? Yeah, let's try. You know, let's get a cannon. Oh, that's not working. What else we got? We got rockets, you know, and let's do that. How, you know, men are stubborn. That's, how long should we do it? I don't know. What year is it? Just keep doing it for 4 years. And then they finally gave up at the exact same time. Don't think that screams structure. When you're firing rockets up from both sides, you know, of the inner circle, and you're just firing rockets up over and over for no apparent reason, you know, and these are big, big bombs. You can't tell me, what are you aiming at? Oh, we're not really aiming at anything. You know, don't give me that. It's crap.
Yeah, we had other places where we were doing nuclear testing that weren't there anyway. So that just, to me, seems like they were attempting to punch through a hole or something.
Yeah.
So many people call that a dome. And a lot of people in the flat earth world hate the idea of a dome. They feel that we're, by even saying that there's a dome, that you're cutting off possibilities. It's very not creative. It's very unartistic. And although it appears in the Bible, if you want to look at the Bible that way, How do you feel about, I know the dome is part of the way you see the flat earth model. What do you think about that fact that an enclosed world, like your website, enclosedworld.com, how people think it's limiting. What do you think?
It is limiting. And I know who you're talking about in this case, because the more creative you are, the more you don't like to be fenced in. And it actually, that leads into one of my clues, which is human beings do not like being enclosed. They don't, which is why the edges have been hidden. The best jail cell, and I don't necessarily want to say that it's a jail or prison planet, but the best confinement is one that you do not know is there. Or not to use the Lawrence Fishburne line from Matrix, but that is, you know, a prison that you cannot see or smell or taste or touch. And that works because human beings do not like that. So yeah, the more creative you are, the more you're going to be resistant to an enclosed system. Could this be a series of worlds like this that, you know, more and more that are out there? Yes, I do think that's very, very possible, because if you're going to make one of these, you're probably going to make more of these, you know, in all different stages and flavors and colors. But do you have access? Are you going to let the people from here get to another one that's over here? I should grab another Frisbee, but that's okay. I'll just use the one. Would you let people go from here to there? I do not believe so, because, and look, I'm giving people the benefit of the doubt when I say this. We are, men in particular, we are dangerous. We do some really violent, horrible things, and we have been doing it to each other for a long time. Now, yeah, if we had a unified purpose, if we had a common goal, would we stop killing each other? I think for the most part, yes, I think we would. But when we're bored, like cats sometimes, we turn our energies inward and start just clawing the drapes and tearing everything up. And we have done a lot of damage to each other. So an enclosed world makes way more sense to me, because you just want to keep us, again, I'll use the box of baby scorpions reference. Box of baby scorpions, they look real cute and adorable sometimes. Do you really want them running amok all over the store? No, of course you don't. You're going to seal this place in, and you're going to let only certain things get out. The general population, no, it's not getting out of here.
Well, no. I have three new kittens, and they're older now a little bit. They're still kittens, but when I first got them, they were only confined to two rooms in my house because they were destroying and knocking things over and climbing the drapes and doing, but now they're a little calmer. So they had their own little dome for a little while. So I can understand that, because we're pretty, I don't know if human beings are violent, but I think the lust for power and money and the haves and have nots do create the violence. I don't think there it's that possible. Yeah,
we do.
Where will we live? How we've been manipulated by authority that creates all that strife.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. We do we don't need much motivation to do bad things to each other. Maybe naturally we're not that bad, but if there's something on the, you know, in the distance that both of us want, we will turn on each other in a second to get it if we think it's valuable to us. But again, I don't hate the flat plane that goes off forever. In fact, I think that outside of this, it does go on for a huge ways, and there's more of these out there. I just think that they're contained. I think that they're, and I'll throw the biblical reference out there. Look, the firmament talks about it right away, and a lot of other cultures do too, that there's some sort of barrier that we're encased. And maybe I'll even do the silver lining side, the kittens reference. And that is, maybe it's not just to keep us out, but to keep us in, to protect us from maybe something that's even worse that's out there. Maybe there are monsters out there, you know, that live in the dark shadows that are outside of this universe.
Well, biblically, and I'm not a religious person, but the waters above, the waters below, and the waters above could be, I mean, if
could
we
be literal.
It could be really water up there, and maybe that's what created great floods, or the great flood, supposedly, yeah, in the Bible. And we would just basically drown if we were allowed out of the dome that's protecting us.
Yeah, we could be in a giant ocean, in which case you really want a dome.
Right.
You know, don't want to break it, which, of course, that's funny, because the joke that we always heard in the conspiracy world about the atomic testing, where there was one of the physicists said, well, you know, there's a possibility. This equation says, you know, we might actually light the atmosphere. We might ignite the atmosphere and burn us all up anyway. And it's like, well, who's going to yell at us? flip the switch, right? and that, you know, so when you're shooting rockets at the dome and you don't know what's on the other side, well, if there's water on the other side, well, only one way to find out, fire, you know.
Crazy. Well, then people, the whole Libyan glass, inexplicable glass that were found, people have said perhaps they are pieces of the dome that have been broken by maybe rockets being shot up or something along those lines. I mean, you never know.
It's possible. I've also heard that some of that, you know, because there's lots of instances, anyone wants to look it up, look at the MK Jessup file, the Varro edition. They talk about huge sheets of ice that have fallen on different parts of the world over time. And some people have suggested to me that that is a bunch of frozen condensation from the inside of the dome, which I thought was also interesting. That, yeah, also may have been shaken by, you know, a combination of weapons, solar activity, who knows?
Well, when you see any NASA launches, you see the rockets go up and then over.
Yeah.
And they do say that they need to do that to go with the curve of the Earth, which makes no sense because, you know, the shortest distance between two points is a straight line, and going up, up and away, to me, not being a scientist, seems the most logical thing. They have their reasons that they say so. I don't believe anything NASA says, but they have found pieces of the part of the rocket that's supposed to, the booster that falls down to Earth after the rocket's launched, in areas almost completely whole. You can even read the writing on it. So that should have burned up in the quote-unquote atmosphere if it had gone as high as it supposedly was supposed to go. But no, they just go into the water pretty much. And so, you know, hey, NASA, thanks for taking our tax dollars and basically disposing of them by polluting the waters, killing sea animals, I'm sure, marine life, and just basically just burning money up that we have no choice but to give to them when you pay taxes. I mean, if you don't like NASA, you're paying every time you pay your taxes for them to continue lying to us.
Yeah.
Agreed. Well, we've only been able to dig like 7.5 miles down into the ground. Russia in the 80s, I think, had a program where they were attempting to bore, to drill through the earth. So 7.5 miles down. We can go how far up? I mean, what's your estimate of how far we can go up?
Boy, that's a tough one. It really depends who you ask, because commercial air traffic, which most of us have been on, caps out at about 10 miles. Spy planes, again, depending on, you know, because officially the United States doesn't even have spy planes anymore, which is great. I love that. Those cap it at about 20 miles. Weather balloons also about that. And so everything else is controlled by a very, very small group of organizations, the European Space Agency, NASA, Japan, Russia. So we don't actually know how high. The general public has no way of telling how high we go up. You know, is it only a few hundred kilometers or miles? Is it 1,000 miles? We don't know exactly, but what we do know is they can't get up far enough to take a picture. We know that much.
It seems like 40 miles. You take like a spy plane, and then you just add a little bit on there, kind of, and then you just say 40 miles. That's kind of what I look at it as, about 40 miles as far as we can go. And maybe if you go up any higher, what do you think, what do you theorize would happen? You hit something like ding, you're forced down by a force field.
It's hard to say. It could be the same sort of pushback soft barrier that's on the outside. I mean, the whole thing, when it comes to the upper part, I don't want to speculate too much because there's so many options. I don't want to rule them out. There's so many cool options that could be up there. You know, do the stars actually get thinner and thinner to the point where there's actually, when you get to a certain point, you can't see stars at all. Not because the sun is blinding them out, but because from a display standpoint, you've actually gone past them, and that you know they're only visible from a certain, you know, from a certain altitude. I've heard several people mention that even in civilian airliners, when they get around 50,000 feet, the stars get thinner and thinner, which is, you know, it has nothing to do with the sun. Don't know, because for me, and I've stated this in several things, the ceiling is really just a giant planetarium. You know, could be hundreds of miles high. I do not know how steep this snow globe is. And then the moon and the sun, which really are tracking around like a, like the yin yang symbol, which is fantastic. I love the yin yang symbol laid on top of that. It's like, where'd that thing come from? Because that lays on top of this map perfectly. The sun and the moon are, you know, at some distance, but they're very, very small. But they're actually physical objects that, that track around us. And I got to mention, because I don't want to forget, because of the moon thing, that that Crow 777 was mentioned in Newsweek magazine today. Yeah. As we're speaking. I thought that was fantastic, because he was tied to mentioning that the NASA photos of Pluto were a fake, and Newsweek actually went out and talked about it and said, anyone wants to look it up, it's out there, that there are people, they call them what, Pluto truthers. I love that, because that is going to be the segue into this. You know, people are going to look at Pluto truthers.
Information is being allowed out. It really is. Yeah. I don't know
There's no reason why Newsweek should have run that story at all. And they mentioned Crow 777 by name. You know, they don't mention his real name. You know, it's not that hard. You know, people can figure it out if they want. It's out there. But he's done videos on this stuff, that he thinks the moon has got real problems. He doesn't trust anything NASA says. I mean, they let him roll with this. And I was reading, I was waiting at the bottom of this thing for, like, to say, you know, astrophysicist, you know, John Doe says Crow 777 is crazy, and here's why. They didn't even do that. They let him go with this. I'm going, why would you release this story? That's Newsweek. So right. Forbes, Newsweek. Oh yeah. This, it's getting really suspicious out there.
Yeah. It's being leaked out a little bit into the super mainstream like that. And it's that in some ways sort of scary, because if they are allowing it, it makes you feel like, it can't be true.
Yeah. Oh,
I don't know. Go ahead.
Can I mention there was two other guys, and I don't know if I talked about these with you. Two other, you know, because I get phone calls and emails every day from people, because most of the information I get nowadays is people saying, hey, have you seen, like, the Newsweek thing? I had that sent to me, like, right away from somebody. I would have never found that on my own, because it wasn't mentioning flat Earth. I would have never seen it, but it's going to get tied to it eventually. But I had a career surveyor. Did I ever tell you about this one? He just called last week. Career surveyor. You know, these are the guys that go out with the tripods and they shoot the level of the land before any building goes up. And he was following the clues. You know, he was going through the whole thing. He calls me up. He goes, yeah, I'm a retired surveyor. Did it for 35 years. He goes, man, I got to tell you, he's going, we never looked at the curve at all. And he goes, it was funny, because he goes, when I was a rookie starting out, he goes, we were shooting. He goes, look, he goes, in fact, I just did a thing for a friend. We were shooting like a quarter mile long driveway. He goes, that's 2 inches of curve right there. He goes, 2 inches? That's huge. You know, because surveyors have to be very, very precise. Their whole mission in life is to be down to, you know, the fraction of an inch, you know, on any land gradient. And he's going, we never ever use it. He goes, in fact, when I was starting out, the older guys were saying, no, you guys just gotta look at the book. He goes, what book? He says, like, there's this book with a bunch of markers that tell you what the elevation is, you know, and how you should account the math and everything. And he goes, you know what's funny about that book and who put the markers in there? I go, no. He goes, the book was made by the USGS. I was going, get out. I go, that's really, really cool. And so he's going to dig into, like, his 1976 survey books and let me know. And I thought that was very interesting. The other one was a guy that worked in industrial valves. I tell you about this one?
No.
Oh, this was great. In industrial valves, what he did was, he, you know, just industrial valve systems, seals and valves, right? And anything involving pressure situations. And he goes, man, I've been watching your stuff. And he goes, there's something really wrong here. And he goes, you know what's interesting? He goes, I was looking at the ISS system. The ISS, right, station, and he goes, I'm comparing it to submarines. And he goes, you know what the ISS doesn't have? And I go, what? And he goes, everything. He goes, you don't understand. There's seals between the compartments in the ISS system that have to be configured a certain way. He's going, it is no different from submarines. He goes, most people don't understand that on all military submarines, they have a full-blown machine shop so that they can build every part from scratch, because when it comes to replacing the seals, they are very, very specific. You have to mold them, you know, right then and there. You've got to go to the shop, you know, make them, put them back in. He's going, there's no machine shop on the ISS, nor would you ever want in a machine shop. One, they're very, very heavy. You know, machine shop is just giant chunks of metal, you know, and machinery. And it was just fascinating listening to him because he was going, look, ISS, everything that you think about, he goes, there's so many things missing up there that people don't know.
Yes.
He's going, how are they replacing all these parts? They're not.
If a micrometeor, which should be there in space, hits part of the ISS, the first thing that they would do would be, you know, all hands on deck, put your spacesuits on, and then seal off that area. And they don't seem to have that ability to seal off that bad area that was hit. So air and, you know, everything that's keeping them alive doesn't go.
Yeah,
and
where are the hatches? Where are the hatches? Show me video where they're flying through. It's like, look, it's again, it's like a submarine. You've all seen the movie, you know, the movies where, look, if a section starts flooding, you close the door, you seal it up, you're done with it. Something goes wrong in that station, those people in the khakis and the polo shirts, they're done, all of them, at the same time. There'd be a guy at a complete end, other end of the station. They have no idea what's going on. He'd be like, why am I dying? He won't know.
You know, I wonder about those people. Like you were saying before, they're given a job to do and told that they have to do it. That they're not really told the whole story. You just wonder about how they live. When I watch the footage of the ISS that's been filmed. I mean, I don't mean live, and I've watched that too, which is kind of just amazingly funny. But just watching, the videos you can see on YouTube of the crew presenting things like, this is how we brush our teeth, this is how we go to the bathroom. They seem very normal. They seem like you or me or any of us talking. They don't seem like crazy, devious liars. No. But they're lying right to us as they're talking. They know what they're saying isn't really true, that they're not in space. And it's scary to know that there's people out there like that. It's different than being an actor or an actress in a soap opera or in a movie, because you're doing a role on purpose and then you're done with the role and you go to your real life. This is really just lying. And it's scary to know there's people out there that can do that.
Yeah,
are they doing it because you think they're threatened if they don't do it? Or tell somebody that you've got to do this. There's no way to say no, because now you're the bearer of the information. You're not going to be allowed back into the civilian population knowing it.
Is it any different than, remember, because these people are all military, you know, and this is the Air Force side of it. True. But, you know, is it any different than a spy that is told, you know, oh, by the way, you're going to be lying basically for a living. Nobody's going to know it. You know, you've got your identity is all going to be changed. You're going to be doing horrible things for God and country, and well, country mostly. And that's what they do. So in this case, they sign the disclosure agreements. They're paid well. They're told, you know, look, you're doing this. It's a national security issue. We can't tell you why you're faking space. You're just going to be faking it. So have a good time. You're not going to be in any danger. And you'll be cool. No different than the Challenger people that have been put up. Again, people who've missed, there's so much stuff out there. Look up Challenger astronauts still alive. That's a perfect example, because those people aren't, where was I going with this?
They still have the same names.
Yeah. It wasn't like the Capricorn.
The same many years later.
Yeah. It wasn't the Capricorn 1 civil situation where you had to kill them. But the point what was getting at is like, look, you got to give up everything when it comes to NASA. And by that, I mean, look, no astronaut has ever sat on top of a rocket that has been shot up into space, because you'd never take that risk.
Right.
Something
goes
wrong.
Have blown up on launch. I mean, are you going to go on there?
Rockets are tricky. So when the Challenger rocket blows up, you're going, oh, crap, we got these seven guys sitting in a meeting room. What do we do with them? You could kill them, but it's like, you already spent some money and time. It's like, oh, let's relocate them and do stuff with them. It's like, okay, you're now your twin brother, Larry. You are your twin brother, Kevin.
Twins in the Challenger.
Yeah, two twins, two people that have twin brothers. It's like, that's just lazy. Come on, do something. And six of them are still alive now. They're spread out all over the country. They've all had successful careers, lawyers and professors and, they're ones running a company, and they've all, when you look at them, here's the thing. They're not ordinary real looking people. They've all got they got interesting faces. So when you're looking at the before, I love the internet. You know, they say, okay, what do you think these people would look like in 30 years? And so here's a picture of them now. Here's a picture of them. Yeah. Same person. Especially that one white guy with that really blonde hair, and his eyes are kind of set apart a little bit. It's going, that's a unique face.
I've stared at each one of them and I see the characteristics. I can look at a picture of myself now and a picture of myself 20 years ago and I see, although I've aged, I see the same basic facial features. That's just how it is. I mean, it's very few people on earth look exactly the same without prosthetics and makeup and, you know, artifice type things going on, like in Hollywood.
As far as acting without guilt, you know, they're paid to do it. Remember, they weren't actors to begin with. So it's like, okay, we're just going to pretend, again, you know, just follow the script. And remember that by that point, they had already followed the military path for so long. Look, it's all about following orders in the military. So, and I'm sure they psychologically screen them before they put them in there. It's like, okay, would you be willing, you know, if there's a secret, it's like, would you be willing to fake this? Fake a disaster, fake a shooting, fake space. You know, what are you up for? You know, and some people like, well, I could fake a shooting. And other people's like, oh, I could be up for faking space. You know, they're separated, you know, because it's all comes down to what's up here.
And these are our heroes. These people that say, yeah, I'd be willing to fake these things. Sure. That's the thing. We want their autograph. I have an autograph of an astronaut. I think you should burn it, basically.
Yeah, that's why, by the way, the Apollo, they're not going to ever repeat what happened with the Apollo astronauts, because it's one thing to fake it. But if you're getting a ticker tape parade in your honor and you're riding on the back down New York. Yeah. Baby. How much of this can you do? Whereas people's like, oh, you know, here, kiss the baby. How many of those can you do before it's like, cause you didn't do anything. You didn't do anything. I mean, yeah, you went through the training program, but
one became an alcoholic. Sort of retired from public view pretty much.
Yeah.
It definitely must mess with your mind. I wonder though, where we know what happened with the people on the Challenger. They're still alive and relocated and have good jobs. I think one, we don't really know what happened. What about the people that are on, supposedly on the ISS? Where are they when they're supposedly on the ISS? I mean, do they send them off to like a plush resort in the Bahamas under a pseudonym?
No. No. You can't ever do that. You've got to cover your bases. You got to send them to a base. You've got to send them in fact, not just to a base. You've got to have them cordoned off in a special wing of a base to where your general personnel does not see them. Because again, you don't want this spreading out. You can't have them walking through, you know, the commissary of like the CIA. It's, oh, hey, Frank. Oh, hey, you know, you can't do that because the less exposure, the better. So you put them, look at them again, not to reference it too much. Look at Capricorn 1. They just literally stayed at that base out in the middle of the desert until they were ready. And then they were taken by private jet to wherever they need to be.
Well, what about the families of those people? Do they think that they're in space? Probably. Of course they do.
Families. Yeah. You wouldn't want to tell them. I mean, again, you could profile them, but yeah, you wouldn't want to tell them.
What about the twin astronauts, the Kelly brothers? One is on Earth and one is in the ISS, meaning both are on Earth.
Right. Where the one of them was married to the woman that was shot at that shop.
Gabriella Giffords, which of course is another supposed hoax, although I don't know whether or not I believe that actually was a hoax. But a lot of people have, you can find many sites on the internet that say that she wasn't really shot, that she's faking being impacted by the bullet hitting her head. Yeah. And then she should have way more facial wounds and much worse going on with her if she had been hit by a bullet. But anyway, that was more of a supposed, if that did indeed happen, it was more about gun control. But then she has her husband, and then there's one astronaut's aboard the supposed shuttle right now for a year in space, and that's the one called Mark Kelly, and you can find him on Facebook, and he's always posting things. Of course, he's never doing a 360 with the camera and taking a picture all the way around, and everything is completely staged and fake looking. But it just makes me feel pretty close to hate for these people. But with those two twin brothers, actually, Mark Kelly can go out and walk around because you could just say he was.
You're right. He can. Twins. I think they found out later that twins actually can be useful.
Yes.
Because then they can actually have lives, and you can do what you want, kinda. You have a lot more flexibility. Let's put it that way.
But
so that worked out.
To sign up for a year in space, you're doing a mission. If there was an ISS and there's exciting experiments you're doing, and you're, you know, changing the world or whatever it is they think they're doing up there. Yeah. But if you're just in a base, a year in a base. It's almost like being in a jail. It better be a pretty darn nice base.
Well, again, yeah, it would be a nice base. They get everything they needed. I wouldn't worry too much about their suffering. Remember, the military, they live on pretty bare bones anyway. So, you know, if they get extra television privileges, I'm sure they could do just about anything they wanted. Yeah. But the main thing is you don't want them running around too much in case something happens, they get hurt. If something, you know, if you get like, if you're driving around and you get in a car wreck, how are you going to explain that? You have to write that into the script. No different than, I'll use a movie reference. When Mark Hamill, the actor from the first Star Wars, you know, Luke Skywalker, he was partying up and after the first start, you know, got in this horrible car wreck, had to have facial, you know, plastic surgery on his face. They had to write that into the script for Empire Strikes Back. You don't want to do that. You know, you don't want to have to wing it. You know, it's like, you know, writers hate that. It's like, oh, how are we going to work this in? So keep them on the base, keep them low key. Don't let, you know, they're chauffeured around. Don't let them do anything dangerous. You know, you're not going to have them. It's like, no, you know, you're not going to go to your house and start remodeling and stuff like that. You fall off a ladder with a nail gun. You know, what if you died? What, if, you know, you don't want to do that. You can't do last minute casting. It's taboo.
Well, you could have he could die, or any of them could die, and then they would have to write that into an ISS accident, because we're always saying, why don't micrometeors hit the ISS? They could say, one did, and Mark Kelly is dead. So, yeah.
You could. Yeah, also, I mean, you could, but but then you got to do it as a group, because you don't want to waste the rest of them, too.
Yeah. That's true. And since they don't have an ability to shut cordon off one area from the other, they would all have to die. So.
Yeah.
See, NASA, you kind of messed yourself up by not thinking about that.
See, gotta think ahead.
Plan. Well, for those who are just joining us, my name is Patricia Steer. This is called Flat Earth and Other Hot Potatoes, and we're discussing the Flat Earth and Other Hot Potatoes, various sort of conspiracies, as well as the Flat Earth. And with me is Mark Sargent of Flat Earth Clues and Strange Worlds. And he's got a Flat Earth Frisbee there, which I wish I had. Super cool.
I'm hoping somebody can use that as like the shot. You know, like in my head, so they don't have to use a Photoshop one of these on top of it.
I like it. I think it's pretty cool. Well, let's go back to the Flat Earth. Okay, there's the AE map. Explain that's importance to the Flat Earth. I know most who are into Flat Earth know this already, but perhaps there's some joining us who don't know.
The AE map, otherwise known as the Azimuthal or Azimuthal Equidistant map, that's Azimuthal. And that map is really, really interesting. You can look that up on Wikipedia. It's part of the list of map projections, Wikipedia last map projections. And it is very, very interesting. Again, it was interesting because it was one of those little tidbits which I found, which I didn't know was there. Nobody pointed it at me. It was just like, wow, you know, just tripped over a rock, and the rock turned out to have symbols on it in this case, where the map, which it looks exactly like this, actually, which is a top-down view of the world. Like if you took a globe and you just crushed it, and Antarctica was spread out to the edges, and then the North Pole would be in the center. The azimuthal equidistant map, or we'll just call it the AE map because it's easier, is out of all the map projections, it's the only one that's actually used by people, which was weird. It was like, you know, everything as far as comments was blank, 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 blank. And this map was used by the USGS, which is the United States a geological survey, which is map makers of the world, which is why I called the third clue the map makers. And it is also used by the UN flag, you know, is the exact same logo as the UN flag. And it is also used by the Flat Earth Society. So it's used, it's the only map out there that's used by multiple groups, and they're not small groups. USGS, very, very big group, 5,000 employees at least, million, you know, millions of dollars in budgets. It's really, really good. The United Nations, also not a small group, but what's interesting about, and this is UN blue, by the way, the color of the UN Frisbee here. United Nations, instead of having the Antarctic around the outside of this thing, they have two wreaths, sort of like, you know, Greco-Roman wreaths around the outside, but they don't explain it. So they don't, the UN flag, even though it should show all the continents, including the really, really big one of Antarctica, I know no one lives there officially, but you'd think you would compensate for that. The UN flag, which was built in 1946, they don't explain why Antarctica isn't on there. It's just unusual. and the Flat Earth Society, which also uses the exact same map as the other, you know, the United States government and the United Nations. The Flat Earth map is considered crazy. It's considered completely insane, and it is not linkable to these other two projections, which is makes no sense. They're, and which is why in the clue I laid them all on top of each other. I'm going, look, they're perfectly identical. Two of them are considered completely legitimate, but they're projections. They're not literal. Whereas the Flat Earth, because they consider it literal, is considered nuts. And you got to look at it and kind of scratch your head. It was one of those where I looked at it and was going, that's really, really interesting. Not to mention the fact that this projection right here wasn't made by an American or anyone in Europe. It was made by a Middle Eastern Persian, as a matter of fact, which is now Iran, Persian scientist from 1,000 years ago named Al-Biruni. I thought that might have been a bad link. So I clicked on it. I was looking at this Al-Biruni guy, big scientist, big Renaissance man of his era. Very, very smart guy. There's statues of him. You know, he's highly regarded as a great scientist. Al-Biruni, NASA knows full well who he is because there's a moon crater on the moon named after Al. It's the Al-Biruni crater. So it's like, why is NASA? Everybody knows what, you know, everybody's tied to this thing in some way. It's hiding in plain sight. It's brilliant. I love it that everybody's missed it.
The Al-Biruni crater is just an Easter egg that they left for us. I mean, there's no other reason other than just to put it there. They have so many different things that they do to us to psych us out or, you know, play with our minds. And we're beginning to find all of them little by little. Yeah. And they are always hidden in plain sight. I mean, just like the whole Flat Earth itself. We've been walking on it all of this time. People have asked me about the Flat Earth, like, how does this work on the Flat Earth? How does that work on the Flat Earth? And I can come up with a pretty good explanation of how various things work. But the real answer to that is, look outside. It's working just fine because you've lived here all your life. That's how the sun goes. That's how that's how all of it happens. That's the real answer. It is working. The spherical model doesn't exist. Yeah. So it's strange that we even have to explain how it works on our map, because it works on the map, the only map.
It's the best trick ever, because because you don't have to look for it. It doesn't have to be set up for you. That's the best part. You know, the street magic tricks, you know, that's it's the finale of all tricks, because everything else, it's like, oh, look over here. Oh, look over here. Look over here. No, the best trick, you've been standing on it your entire life. We've all been, you know, all our history is based off of this, and we never knew. That's what I love about this thing, because you got to admire it from a deception standpoint. Yeah, nobody likes to be lied to, but from a deception standpoint, even before the authority decided to hide it for the last 60 years, it's brilliant. Because it's all encompassing and it fooled everyone. It is the quintessential P.T. Barnum saying, which is all of the people can be fooled some of the time. You can't fool them forever on something like this. You can only fool them for so long, because sooner or later the civilization is going to develop, you know, unless it was like an Amish civilization, which you'd never ever find out, but then that plot becomes boring. They let the civilization develop. They let it advance in technology to the point where they could find the edges, where they could map out the sky. And that even added a whole nother flavor to it, which is like, you know what? The elite are trying to keep this thing secret. It's like, how long do you think they're going to be able to pull that off? Well, about 60 years. And now it's falling apart, which is, again, it's a great finale if that's what this comes to.
We can reach the average person who's got a camera with a zoom or even their cell phone can look at the curvature of the Earth measurements that are supposed to exist, and then, you know, use your camera to zoom in and see that you can see farther than you're supposed to, because of course the curve wouldn't have allowed it. So just Joe Average or Jane Average can do it. And so it's beginning to break down, although there is so much resistance against it. And of course, most people who are in the, all people who are involved with the Flat Earth, they speak about it openly and are okay with being called stupid or crazy, or they don't talk about it. And I actually encourage everybody to talk about it in whatever way that you can, among your friends, your family, your coworkers. Just drop a seed. It doesn't matter if you're called stupid, because being a curious person, being a person who's interested in finding out more about where you live, there's nothing stupid about that. And people who call you that, they're the ones with the problem. It says more about them than it does about you. So definitely speak out. It's how we bring this to critical mass.
And again, you'll be glad that you did, because everybody calls it stupid right away, except for you, because you're weird. Everybody calls this thing dumb right away, including me. Look, I was more stubborn than most. I was sitting there banging my head on that desk. Well, maybe not. Actually, it was that desk for 9 months, just going, it can't. It's a globe. It's a globe. It's a globe. I know it's a globe. I know I can prove it's a globe. And it wasn't. So don't feel bad, because everyone starts out in the same boat. 99.99% of the people, I should say, start out in the same boat, which is it's ridiculous. They roll their eyes at it. They make fun of it. They laugh. And after a while, it sinks in. Sometimes you can do it in a couple of days. Sometimes it takes a couple of weeks. And if you have a lot of followers and you're a professional debunker, well, you're going to hold on forever. And as I've said before, if you're an astrophysicist or an astronomer, oh, there's nothing I can do for you. You're going to crawl into a very nice bottle of Johnny Walker Blue at the end, and you're not coming out, because that's where you're going to spend the rest of your life. So, don't feel bad. Tell people. Don't, of course, alienate your family if you can help it, or, totally shut down your friends. Try to do it gently. Don't walk up with a picture like this and say, it's a flat earth. You got to follow it. You don't do that. But at the same time, it's you got to be subtle. In fact, I still don't use flat earth until the very, very end. I tell people enclosed world. I tell people Truman Show, because that's the one they can relate to. Oh, it's that funny movie with Jim Carrey. It's like, and again, that shows you how good the conditioning is, because I can talk about the Truman Show for 15, 20 minutes to somebody. Don't bat an eye. I say flat earth, they start backing up. They get that look in their eyes. So it's like, ooh, I'm dealing with a crazy person.
Crazy Christian. Somebody who wants to send us all to the dark ages. Somebody who doesn't science.
There you go. And yes, there is some religion tied to this. No question. I wasn't shying away from it that much, which is, look, all your major religions, and by that I mean Judaism, Buddhism, Hinduism, Islam, and Christianity, they all talked about this at one point or another. And that makes up, 80% of the population. So don't, it's like, Vine, you want to pick on religious people? Well, that's 8 out of 10 people. So good luck dodging them for the rest of your life. Yeah, it is somewhat tied to archaic religious belief or outdated science. But you got to remember that this used to be the science for thousands of years. This was the model. This is what we did. It only changed recently. Do I think the builders had something to do with it? Yes, they do. Do I think the secret societies had something to do with covering it up? Yes, I do. If I end up writing a book on this, because I one of these days it may come to that. I was thinking of actually titling it "Back to Flat," because we're circling back to this finally. It's where we were born. It's where we started. It's where we should end up before this big ride ends. And they should be exposed that where you are. Everyone wants to know. It's like, where am I? What am I a part of? What's my place in the universe? Oh, this makes it a lot simpler.
Yeah, it is. It does make it a lot simpler. And I found out about it just, stumbling through YouTube. I've always been into conspiracy and that sort of thing. And I just found Flat Earth Clues, and I found Eric Dubé's work, and Matt Boylan, Matthew Powerland, and just digested all of that in approximately 2 days. And I was by myself when I did it, and I didn't come up for air during that period of time. I was in my house by myself, didn't leave, just digested this, watched all those videos, watched them again, just sort of fascinated and excited. And I never once said, oh, this is just a lie. This can't be. Because there was something about it, and I don't know how to explain it other than it resonated with me. It felt right, and it seemed to answer vague questions that I've always had that I can't even put words to about life as it's been presented to us, and how it all seemed slightly wrong. And I never felt that there was a reason. What's the reason for even being here? And the Flat Earth gave me a feeling that there was a creator or creators, which I did not have before. And something like a purpose in a way, more than I had before. And I think a lot of people are finding that. And whether it takes them deeper into their particular religious belief, I didn't have one, or just to find that there is a creator at all, whether it's several people who just created this just to study us or whether it's a creator that has some sort of a godlike aspect to it. It's something that's changed my life. I mean, I have a YouTube channel. I didn't have one before. It's given me sort of a passion. Veganism has been a huge passion of mine, and this is now an equal passion. And I see them, although many people think they're not related, as being related because, you know, we all live here, the animals and the humans. So I haven't really talked much about veganism, but do you think, I know you're not vegan, we'll just make this part brief.
I have an opinion on it. Go ahead.
Yeah. Do you think that the flat earth in general, if it ever reaches critical mass, do you think that it would change the way that humans think of animals and treat animals?
Yes, I do. I didn't touch on it in the clues because I was trying to go for broader strokes, but you've got quite a point there, which is if we, you know, when this comes out, because it's going to come out sooner or later, you guys are going to have to deal with it, those who are doubting it. When it comes out that we're on an enclosed flat system, it's going to change. The first thing it's going to change is how we treat each other, obviously. You know, will there be wars? Will there be a need for war? Will anybody commit hate crimes? What about racism, sexism? Anything where you're doing something malicious to somebody else, another human being, those all things have to be reevaluated immediately. Because at that point you're going, okay, if we're for a reason, you know, there'll be a lot of speculation. But once you get past the human on human interaction, then people will start revisiting the Ten Commandments. I guarantee that, where it's like, thou shalt not kill. Okay, kill what exactly? Kill animals? Any animals? What kind of animals? And that will filter down to what we all know, I know you don't like the term, livestock. Which is, at that point, should we be killing animals for food? Boy, that's a tough one, but I know there'll be a big resurgence in that idea because it's like, look, because that it'll be a natural progression. It's like, look, if we're not supposed to be killing each other and everybody stopped war, then why are we killing anything for the most part? And what does that define? You know, it's like, there'll be a lot, there'll be some heated debates over that because you've got some massive industries out there that will completely brace against it. You know, the beef, the chicken, the pork industry, the fishing industry,
dairy industry.
Yeah, it'll be bad for a while because there will be a lot of butting up against this. But you've got an excellent point, and that is if we should be treating our world better then we're treating it now, then you would think that all the native species that are in there, because we're obviously the only non-native species in this ecosystem, should be treated better as well. And then things will have to be retooled. So yeah, I do think there would be a resurgence in veganism, vegetarianism, take your pick. It's going to be, it'll be an interesting time, that's for sure.
Yes, I hope I live to see it. In fact, my greatest fear is, let's talk a little bit about the prophecies or things that people do say may happen in September, since we are here recording this on September 1st, about some kind of man-made or sort of natural disasters and events and potential hoaxes that could be happening in September. My biggest fear is that if something does happen, I will be taken out immediately. Let's say if the government says it's an asteroid, but really they drop a big bomb on a city, and if it's my city and if I just die instantly, well, that might be an easier way to go, not have to deal with the hassles afterwards of living in a sort of post-apocalyptic world.
Yeah.
But I want to be around to know what they're going to pull off, what games they're going to play, and I'm hoping that they leave things like the internet and television, although I don't watch it, and cell phones and all of that available. And I think they will, because they are going to need us to be watching the way they manipulate whatever hoax event, let's call it, that they pull off in September, if indeed they do pull something off. What do you think?
I agree with everything. It's amazing how much we think alike. It's freaking me out sometimes. You're absolutely right, which is what's coming. What one they need the media to pull this off. I have said several times on various things that I've done that the end will be televised. It will be in HD. It will be on the internet because you need it to mold the perceptions of what's happening. You need to steer whatever's happening in the public's eye. You need to say, okay, this is happening. This is why it's happening. And here's what you should do. They're going to try to steer the public no matter what happens. So when it comes to September, if something happens, yeah, could it all be nothing in September? It's very possible. If something was going to happen, though, if something was going to go down, you would want to keep the power grid up as long as possible, keep the internet up as long as possible, and television, because television is still the lowest common denominator that's out there. Twitter, Facebook, yeah, you're going to need those, you know, to a certain degree as well. But, you know, when it comes to September, oh, my Lord, how many things could possibly happen? There's so many things stacking up in a row here. It's hard to, that's why people are having a hard time picking any of them, because there's so many things. You know, is it tied to the blood moons? Is it a ritual, religious event? Is Jade Helm tied to it? Is the Pope making an address to Congress? Is Putin being in the country have something to do with it? Is the fact that China, you know, the Chinese leaders are now going to be in the country all of a sudden around the same time? That just was announced today. In fact, I was joking with somebody because they said, oh, yeah, you know, the Pope's going to be in the country. And I ignored this for the longest time, beginning of this year, because I'd seen too many things over the years. And honestly, if you followed Planet X, it was such a big letdown that you're going, I'm not going to buy anything now.
Right.
But this thing was stacking up with so many different things. And it wasn't a one big one. It was a lot of medium-sized ones. And they're saying, well, you know, it's a terrorist event that's going to be planned for the East Coast. You know, it's a CERN event. I mean, there's like 10 or 12 things right now that are like, and they're not small. They're not huge, but they're all about the same sort of size that they could be used in combination for you. Just go boom, 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 you know, touch them off like fireworks. And they would all augment each other. You know, people saying, well, you know, I've talked about this way, like Jade Helm cannot work on its own. It is not big enough an operation that you cannot, you're not just going to send soldiers running amok when during peacetime. It's like on a day like today, it's not going to happen. Now, but if Jade Helm was used in a combination of other things, like a giant terrorist event or some weird blood moon thing, something was going on in the sky or some other stage thing, then yeah, Jade Helm would actually work pretty well.
Right.
With CERN, who knows what's going on there? They open it up a doorway to what? Anyone wants to see what could happen there? Look at the movie The Mist with Thomas Jane. That'll freak people out. But where was going with this?
All the different things that are, you know.
Oh, yeah. All the different things that could happen. Could they happen? Yes. Could it happen September? Yeah, it's September 1st, and already the stock market took a big nosedive on September 1st. I like that as a, you know, you want that as a good indicator? It may not happen. Yeah, maybe, because they were blaming it on China right away, which I thought was interesting, especially since the market took that big hit last week.
Right.
So
the economic crash is another piece to the puzzle that is predicted to happen in September, along with the other things. Also, a fake alien invasion. Or, well, they say an alien invasion.
Could Project Bluebeam be tied to this? Could you stage? Yeah, because if you're going to stage something really, really big, you got to remember the flat Earth, there's no coincidence that this thing's coming out right now. It is tied to this in some way. How it's tied to it, boy, I'm still trying to figure it out, because the things that are happening right now are just making me dizzy. Because I was kidding. I was joking with a friend. I said, oh, yeah, the Pope's going to be in town, right? I said, I'm not worried unless other people show up, right?
Yeah, I agree. I found out the other day, then I think I told you, Putin's scheduled to come. And then Putin, today,
what's he doing in town, right?
Well, just got scheduled, and then today...
Yeah, somebody put together the graphics from the from 2012 with John Cusack, when they start buzzing everybody on their phones, all the elite people saying, get to the frickin' Ark, right? You know, because in this bit, of course, that was when the Ark was somewhere in Mongolia or something like that. But what if the United States is the safest place in the world? You know, a certain parts of the United States, like maybe underneath the Denver International Airport or something in some mountain, you know, take your pick. Maybe it's a game of musical chairs right now, where the leaders are kind of like, oh, maybe we should go to America in September, you know, kind of hang out for a little while. And if something goes wrong, boom, they go in. You know, Putin being here while the Pope's here, China, you know, the Chinese leaders being here while those two guys are here. Who else you know, we're in September 1st. If something happens next week where they're saying, oh yeah, by the way, you know, the G20 is going to make an unscheduled, you know, thing, you know, where they're going to tour something in America or do something at the UN. It's like, you know, start watching. It's going to be a weird fall.
I've been looking forward, if this makes any sense, to September for many months, ever since I started hearing about all of these things happening and as more things happen. And that doesn't mean I'm looking forward to, you know, Armageddon or anything like that. It just means there's been so many, you know, like the Mayan calendar and all of these things have happened that I'm sick and tired of all of the, you know, the psych outs that we've faced with these things. And I don't want something to happen, but I want it to, I mean, come on already. If you're going to do something bad to us and we have no control over it, let's get it over with. Quit toying with us.
I was just going to, it's weird that you're doing this because that's exactly what I was going to say. That was, look, I don't, in fact, I'll use your thing, but I'll turn it slightly different. And that is, you're absolutely right. There's, at this point, look, I don't want bad things to happen to good people either. I don't. But if you're going to do it, just freaking pull the trigger and do it. Whatever you've got planned, whatever the big mystery is that you're going to spring on us, and you know that seems to be either the most sinister thing in the world or the most wonderful thing for our own good and thing in the world, whatever it is, just make the move. What are you waiting for? This, you know, we're in a downward spiral now. You know, the stock market is propped up on toothpicks. You know, nobody's happy at the moment. You know, as far as I know, the world is not a happy place. Could it get any worse? Yeah, it could get worse. But if you got a big plan, what are you doing? What are you doing? You could have done this 5 years ago and you didn't do it. So yeah, I know exactly. And again, I don't want bad things to happen to people, but I'm tired of just what, you know, it's like build up, nothing. Build up, nothing. Like, look, bring Act 3, bring it on. You know, I think the people are ready for it.
Well, they say all the time as well that there may be forces, perhaps, well, people call them archons or whatever you want to call them, that feed off our negative energy. So that could be the reason that a lot of things are told to us that are really, really bad or shown to us that are really, really, really bad through the media so that we are paranoid and full of fear and then nothing happens, but then they've got their dose of the fear energy that they want. I know that you have night vision glasses and you sometimes scan the sky, and you've said this before in your Strange World show. That you can hear on, go to the Mark Sargent channel if you haven't heard Strange World and you've only heard Flat Earth Clues. He has what amounts to basically a radio show, I guess that's a good way to describe it. Yep. And you have mentioned looking at the skies with night vision glasses, and you've seen something up there. Can you explain what you've seen and how that relates to the Flat Earth?
Sure. In fact, it was funny because I stopped really looking after I found out it was Flat Earth, because then I understood it. And I understood it so much more. But several years ago, I was watching a YouTube video, funny thing. And there was this British guy who was kind of in silhouette, you know, trying to stay hidden. And at the end of his like 2 hours or whatever it was, and I cannot remember who the guy was to save my life, he goes, you want to see something interesting? And I wasn't really listening too much. He goes, you want to see something interesting? He goes, get some night vision. Go outside and look up. Tell me what you see. I was going, that's, you know, I'm weird enough that it's like, yeah, I'll take that bet. You know, have a couple of drinks. Let's do this.
I want to buy some now just because you've talked about this. It's on my list of things I want to purchase.
Oh, it's cool. You know, I went out and I shopped around and I bought and then returned probably 4 or 5 different pairs of night vision binoculars on Amazon. And I ended up going out with Night Owl. They're almost all made in Russia. This particular thing was made in Belarus.
I do have to say that naysayers are going to say he must work for Night Owl. He's trying to promote things.
No. Night Owl. Ask for it by name. No.
No, it's a company.
I'm not doing that. It was just the best one for me.
I'm going to look into it. I'm going to go on Amazon and check those out.
Night owls are cool. I mean, because you don't need to get Gen 3 or Gen 4, because there's the difference between Generation 1 and like Generation 3 night vision is that you can tell that the clarity is much better at shorter range. And the whole purpose, like Generation 3, was that you could tell if the person that was coming at you down the road was a friend or a foe. so you didn't shoot them. But when you're looking at stars, it makes no difference. So you can use generation one, which is what night owls are. That's all they are. Generation one, it's green, you know, your standard green night vision stuff. So I go out there, I get the, you know, I get them in the night vision binoculars, and I go out and I start looking around. And I was going, and yeah, you know, it's perfect. You know, you're looking up in the sky, you know, it takes like 30 minutes for your eyes to get adjusted at night, different than day. It takes a lot longer. But I'm looking, I'm going, you know, without the night vision, I'm going, nope, nothing up there. Put on the night vision stuff, and it was like They Live. It's like all of a sudden the sky is like, what's that? What's that? You know, there's things all over the place. I'm just going, oh, that's interesting.
But somebody might say, well, those are satellites.
Those are satellites. And that's exactly what I said. I was going, oh, I'm going. In fact, I remember talking to my family and I said, calling them up and saying, because this was what I did in Colorado, which was perfect conditions because it's very thin air and not a lot of clouds. And I said, wow. I go, there's a lot of satellites up there. So I go the next night because I was going, wow, this is really cool. Because when you start doing, you're going to get hooked. So I go out and I'm going, because I start going in the snow and, you know, it didn't really matter. You know, I didn't drink that much when I was doing it, but it was actually kind of fun as long as you didn't get that double vision going.
Yeah.
Because you're laying down, I got like a plastic mat. I was laying on these AstroTurf fields out at the edge of town, which was kind of fun too. Trying to get as little city light as possible. So I'm watching this one go and I was going, oh, it's another satellite. I'm starting to get a little bored and the satellite slows down and stops. And then it decides to make a left-hand turn and it just takes off and then accelerates and goes ballistic, you know, to the point where I couldn't see it anymore at a really high rate of speed. I was going, okay, so what exactly have I been looking at this whole time? And so then I start following everything that's going across the sky. And sure enough, yeah, some of them are just going from one end to the other. Others are going and they turn. Others, they turn back. You know, and it just goes, you know, there's tons and tons of them. And I started realizing at first before I did the flat earth thing, I started realizing I was going, there's a lot of stuff up there. And I do not think for a second that it's ours, you know, because people say, oh no, that's just military stuff. And you're in Colorado and, you know, you got Cheyenne Mountain and NORAD and all this fun military technology. I go, no. I don't buy that for a second because of all the, you know, look up the UFO stories over the years. It is not. There's the stuff that we do is a fraction of what's up there. Anyone has any doubt, look at the 1561 Nuremberg event. I challenge anybody to look it up. It is not sundogs in Germany. The most fantastic UFO thing of all time. Anyway, the point was, once I got into the flat earth stuff, everything changed because it made way more sense because I was following stuff and it looked like some sort of rush hour because there were certain times of night where there was way thicker than others. And I was trying to, it was almost like they were doing a commute. It was like they were going to work, like same thing we were. They were following our highways, using them as markers, the two main highways out there, 25 north and north south and 93. And I kept going, where are they going? Where are all these things going? It's like they're here with us, right? That's what was bugging me. It's like they're just on a different level than we are. You know, they're using the Jetson cars, whereas we're using the stuff down below, but they're not allowed to communicate with us. Therefore, we're not there. And since their engines are perfectly silent, you know, they're obviously using some sort of unified field engine. But since they're silent, if we don't hear them and we can't see them without night vision, we don't know they're there. So then the flat earth thing came and I was going, oh, I get it now. They're just us. They're just another version of us. Maybe a previous, maybe we are version 6. Who's version 5? Who's version 4? Were there survivors? I'm guessing, yeah.
Reminds probably. Me of the Matrix.
Yeah. Not to steal from the Matrix too much, but yeah. You know, these. So some people will say, well, you know, they can move from one of these to another, you know, outside. I'm just going, yeah, maybe they can. Maybe they can't. Maybe they're stuck in here with us. Maybe it's all about the breakout, which is they want to get out too, but they can't figure it out. So they're just flying around doing their stuff. And every civilization, this is just a theory, and I know you have your point you want to make, but every civilization maybe has a novelty about them, a creative problem solving that no other civilization has. So when they're looking at ours, it's like, okay, how would you break out of this dome? Or they're looking, it's like, what do they got? What can they use to help us get out of here? And it's like, well, they got atomic weapons. No, that's not bad. It's not working though. What else you got? You got HARP. That's a frequency thing. Yeah, maybe we can, sort of mess with the frequency. It's not working. What else you got? Oh, they got this CERN thing. Yeah, that might work. Maybe we can bypass the whole dome thing, open up a gateway to somewhere else. So there's so many great little possibilities and angles. I love thinking about them. I do. It's
really theoretical, but it's really fun. And if you're seeing things with night vision, those things are something, and they're not satellites, because as you were saying, that they're going.
Oh yeah, they're not. No, they're not satellites.
And satellites, which I don't believe exist anyway, are going always the same. Can you? You know how you can look up, even using your phone, finding out when the ISS supposedly is going to fly over your area. Yeah. Can you go out with your night vision glasses and see the ISS?
Depending,
I know there is no ISS, but see whatever.
There's something up there that resembles the ISS.
Yes.
And there are people that have shot it with night vision, and they're out there. I never saw it myself. The tricky thing about night vision is they only come in, the magnification is fairly low. The biggest I think you can get, I mean, you can get a 10X. Those are pretty expensive. I recommend 5X for most people, because 10X isn't going to give you that much more anyway, because these things are flying, whatever they are, pretty high. They're way above commercial air traffic. And I knew, by the way, since I was right next to DIA, I knew the commercial air traffic. You could hear them. You could see them. They're inbound from the north and outbound to the south. They were easy to tell between these things and commercial air traffic. But yeah, is there an ISS? Is there something up there flying that resembles the ISS? Yeah, you bet. Are there people on it? No, there's no people on it. Not a chance in the world. But you got to ask yourself why. That's the big question. And because people say, what about satellites? I was going, what about them? Because if you're, again, you've heard this argument from me. If you're faking people on the ISS, you got to tell me why you're doing it. I think you're doing it because you can't put people up there. And if you can't put people up there, then what are you doing with satellites? Not to mention you got that whole thermosphere problem, which is if the thermosphere is thousands of degrees, why are you getting no damage to these satellites at all? Aren't these things, they're delicate little pieces of machinery. You should be cooking these things. And not to mention you're also going through that band with, you've got people flying up there, the space shuttle that's got no heat problems in the thermosphere. The space station, nobody's got any problems with the thermosphere at all. It's silly.
Well, I mean, even if you take it back to the ISS, you can say if you're faking the Apollo missions, then right there, that to begin with, once you find out they fake that, the next question is why? And people always jump to, it was a space race with the Russians and they fake those, but then they really were able to go up and now they do. That all the space exploration of the Pluto flyby and the Mars rover, that's all real.
Yeah.
And I think about that and just have this to say, a liar always lies. And they lied then and they just keep the lie going now. I mean, there's no way that they can stop lying about it. That's just really the way it is. We've talked for about an hour now, 2 hours now. And are you available to stay for like maybe 15 more minutes?
Or I can stay for you. I will stay for a little while longer.
All right, wonderful. I'm Patricia Steer, and you're watching Flat Earth and Other Hot Potatoes. This is video number 3, and my guest, as you probably can tell, is Mark Sargent of Flat Earth Clues.
Hello.
Flat Earth Frisbee. And also Strange World, and you can find that on his channel. And he also has strangeworld.com. That's his website. And what else? Oh, I do want to let you know that I have a Facebook page called Flat Earth and Other Hot Potatoes, and I encourage you to go and like it. I post all sorts of interesting videos collected from all of my favorite YouTubers and brand new people, and just post information as much as I can. And I would encourage you to like the page Flat Earth and Other Hot Potatoes and post something of your own there.
Before you get to the last questions, I think you should make a shameless plug for that you're looking for a logo and a theme song.
Yes, I am. I'm looking for somebody who's artistically minded to come up with a logo for Flat Earth and Other Hot Potatoes. And I'm also looking for, as Mark said, a theme song, something that would be a minute or a minute and a half. And if you can look over my shoulder here, you can see that the Smiths is my favorite band. So I kind of gear more towards sort of 80s kind of thing, not really country music or something like that. So I want something that has lyrics that have something to do with conspiracy, veganism and the flat earth. And I know that's pretty hard. It's a hard ask. But I know there are very many creative people in the flat earth community. And also, because they're creative, they may have musical abilities. So let me know if you're able to come up with something and we can work with lyrics. And of course, I will credit you in each and every video in print and verbally. And maybe that might help your career, or I don't know, maybe sink your career. I'm here to help either way. Anyway, let's ask a few more questions of Mark Sargent. And oh, for those of you who just started watching and didn't listen to the beginning of the program, I have not enabled chat in this if you're watching the Google Hangout. It doesn't matter if you're just watching this at a later date, because I attempted to and it didn't work. And I'm going to try to work that out for my next video, which will be with Michael Lewis of Stars Our Souls. That will be this coming Sunday, which is every Sunday is when I do it with him at 5 p.m., no matter the date, unless something really bad happens at the end of September and we have no more internet. All right. You have to add that into everything now.
That's good.
You look around and you see concerts are scheduled for November and December and events and the elections are scheduled. You know, it makes you think, oh, you know, nothing's going to happen. It's going to be totally normal. And then you look at the stock market and you think, Putin's coming. You know, it just makes you think. And I do encourage everybody, it may sound doom and gloom, but I did mention earlier in the broadcast that I'm a prepper. And I know that makes it seem as if I'm wearing military camo and I'm locked and loaded. You can see I'm not wearing any camo, I'm wearing lip gloss. And I am a bit of a prepper. I have all the supplies that I would need, pretty much, to hole up for a while if something bad happened. Not something incredibly horrible where the world becomes like Mad Max or the movie The Road, but I'm talking about to be able to take care of myself. And although I don't have family members with me, my three cats, I've got it all under control. And I just encourage anybody, it doesn't mean you're crazy if you've got some non-perishable canned food and some flashlights and a bunch of batteries and a lot of water and pet food covered, and if you have any medications and garbage bags and a plentiful supply of towels. And well, if you would like a free guide on that, Mark, take it away.
What? Oh yeah, by the way, yeah, I love the fact that, by the way, you're a prepper. It just makes me smile. Because
I lived through Hurricane Katrina, and as I mentioned earlier in this broadcast, I had everything I needed and was able to help my neighbors before I left town. So even before that, my mom, at one point in the 70s, when we were very little, bought dried food from somebody and kept it in the house because she was afraid things were going bad. There was a gas crisis. I was really young, but nothing ever happened. So we ended up eating the dried granola, which was really horrible. She bought it from one of those bulk supplier places. And my mom wasn't really a prepper, but my mother was one of those people who were very practical. And really, being a prepper to the degree that I'm at is really just being practical, because the things I have stocked away are things I eat anyway. So, you know, I don't have any special bulk packages from special places. They're from the grocery store. So, you know, that's all I encourage anybody to do. Just have, people don't have more than 3 days of food and water in their house, most people.
No.
And it's just crazy. It's actually really not smart. So not just because of what we're talking about, just do it anyway. Do it anyway, just because you and your family deserve you deserve to be in a good situation where you can help others if stuff does go bad. And I'm talking about power out for 3 days just because a truck ran into a pole. Anything. Yeah. But anyway, Mark, you put out a free prepper guide.
I did. I wrote a prepper blog back shortly after the financial crisis happened in end of 2008, beginning of 2009. And I was really more inspired by the Katrina thing. Because out of all the people, you know this as well as anybody, out of the people that came back to the city, 3 out of every 4 people that came back still didn't prep anything. And it was like, that just drove me insane. I was going, come on, guys. I go, denial is one thing, but it's like, don't tell me after being hit by lightning that, oh, well, it's never going to happen again. Therefore, I don't have to prep. Don't use that as logic. That is just silly. But my blog really went into the thing behind it was, that look, people were hypocrites when it comes to this stuff. We have insurance for everything you can think of under the sun. Literally, you know, car, home, auto, life, You know, family, dental, you know, we've got insurance for it. But the thing is, that's just paper and numbers. Nobody puts aside a little bit of water and a little bit of food, maybe a few batteries, just in case something really bad happens. Nobody does that. That's the funny, you know, when, so we're prepared for all the, for some horrible things, but if ever just goes nuts, you know, complete shutdown, at least for a little while, whether it be a tornado or a hurricane or zombies, take your pick. Nobody does it. And that drove me nuts. So, you know, I said, look, I've got to get this off my chest just so my conscience is clear. And what I did was I did a blog, and then I made a guide, a PDF for it. I printed out hard copies, sent to all my family. And in fact, I keep one in my briefcase just for the heck of it, so I can show people. And then I decided, when I was doing the flat earth stuff, you know, once the September stuff started creeping up, I said, you know what, I'm just going to start, just give it away to, I mean, I was giving it away anyway. I was never selling it, but I want to make people aware of it. So I made a quick video, said, look, free, you know, prepper guide for flat earth friends, kind of a little tie off, you know, the flat earth friendship thing. And I wasn't kidding. It was like, look, anyone wants to email me, and that's M Sargent, that's MSARGENT 23, has nothing to do with September 23rd, MSargent23@comcast.net. If you email me, you don't even have to say anything in the email. If you don't want to say anything nice, just write prepper guide in you know, the title or whatever you want. I want prepper guide. I've had all sorts of people send me that. I will email you the PDF. It's only about 2 megs. It's easy to get through. It's about 100 pages. And even the prepper guide is meant for people that still don't want to prep anything. You don't want to prep anything. You don't want to get anything. Fine. At least this will give you some sort of a fighting chance. So you don't, it'll put you in the right frame of mind, so you won't panic and start chewing off your own arm. And
I like that prepper guide a lot. And I also, immediately when you put out that video, I saw people's comments, and reading comments can sometimes do your head in on videos because of, just what, and sometimes they make you feel really great about humanity. But in this case, a couple of people said, oh, right, well, he's a shill. He's in that prepper guide. There's definitely selling. He's selling like a 1-800 number, some military supply company. It's fear porn. It's Alex Jones. Well, I asked Mark for the prepper guide, and just for fun, not because I was trying to see if he had those things in there. I just, as being a fellow prepper, I just wanted to see, what does he have in there that he got that I don't got? So I looked at it, and there's not a brand name named. There's no 1-800 number. There's no suggestion to go to any military surplus. There's nothing in there at all that would lead me to believe that you were data mining by getting people's email addresses.
Yeah, because I need to do that.
I mean,
let me address that real quick. Yeah. Data mining individually like that doesn't exist anymore. All right, the powers that be have full-blown access to every data source that's on the internet. That's Facebook, that's Twitter, that's YouTube, that's everything you do. They already have access to that. They do not, the phishing things, that hasn't been done in a long, long time, if it was ever done at all. So no, I am not phishing for this, but you're absolutely right. I don't endorse any one product in the guide. I don't even pick a gun for you. I say, look, here are the guns you could choose. I just, you know, not by brand name. I just say, look, here are the types if you want to do it. The only thing I may endorse at all, and I, you know, this is, they're not paying me a dime, would be the boxes to store this crap in, which is, cause I've gone through a lot of different boxes over the years, and the ones I like, it's called Action Packer, which is made by Rubbermaid. That's the only thing I could even mention. I didn't even mention that in the guide, but I'll mention it here because they are cool little boxes. They're not cheap though. So most people wouldn't get them anyway. They're like $25 a crack, and they only hold like 8 gallons worth of stuff.
Yeah. So, well, it's a good idea if you have a bottle of water to store them in those kinds of containers.
Yeah, yeah. Get a plastic container. I don't care. You go to Home Depot, there's tons of generic stuff out there. Those are the ones I use though.
People wonder, why do you put your plastic bottles in one of those containers? Because they leak eventually.
Oh, they're thin.
Yeah, they're thin. You
know, the water things, those are deadly. I put everything in plastic containers.
Me too.
So the animals don't get to them, so that if they get dropped, you know, you don't get a lot of damage. The plastic container takes the damage, not the items inside it. Take your pick. But it's a great little guide. I had a lot of fun writing it, and it's somewhat lighthearted. You've read through some of it.
Yeah, it's funny. It's got some humor in there. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. I try not to, I mean, I'm not joking like a zombie survival guide. You know, I'm not saying that it's, you know, it's do this to stop zombies. In fact, it's disaster generic. So it's not saying that it doesn't care whether you're, it basically doesn't care if you're in a hurricane or a tornado or anything like that. It is just, is look, if the power goes out, that's the big thing. If the power goes out for any extended time, you're going to need to do something. You're going to, and if it's big enough, and you know, that's why the September thing came up. If it's big enough, the power goes out and it doesn't come back on, and you don't have any idea, it's not isolated like the Northridge earthquake or Katrina or a tornado. If it's not isolated, you're just getting the emergency broadcast system. You gotta start thinking about, I know people don't like thinking about it, but look, this guide will take that out of the equation for you. You can just read through there, you know, print out. And by the way, if you get it, print some of it, print chapters of it, put it away, because I will have no sympathy for you if something bad goes, you know, happens. And it's like, oh, you know, I had this guide on my phone and I can't access it because it's on the cloud now. It's
right. That's the same thing about anything that you happen to have in your house. Like you have a flashlight and there's instructions on how to load the batteries, but you don't know how to do it because you never use the flashlight. Yeah. Don't just rely on the internet where you can go and look up how to do it, print that out, have it. It's something that I'm always looking things up online all the time, but if something is super important, you definitely should print it out. It sounds like we're super doom and gloom. There's a flip side to this. Potentially at some point, things I feel are going to change. And I felt that during my lifetime, they're going to change. And as I said earlier, one of my worst fears would be things change and it's after I'm long gone, or that when they change, I'm taken out immediately. I want to be here to see what the changes are, see what the powers that be, the authority, is going to do, what game they're going to pull on us. And I also want to participate in any sort of recovery or help others as much as I can. So what do you think? Let's spin it, not spin it positively, but you know, we're talking about CERN and, you know, portals. And what about, is there anything good that can come out of this?
If we're all gonna die.
Anyway. So
no. Yeah, just pack it in. You know, say goodbye to your loved ones. Don't make any long term plans. No, as far as I can spin it positively, and that is, look, we have to something. The tipping point, whatever happens with our civilization, it's not going to be roses by any stretch. It is not going to be without loss, no question. No matter where this goes, because there's too many people, there's not enough resources, and we've been doing a lot of bad things over the years. So if you want to rebuild, if you want to go to a new golden age, if you want to see what the future really can be like, and I mean a bright future where we can do so much more, we can actually reach our potential, you're going to have to, you know, I hate to say it, you're going to have to go through the gauntlet first. This will help. This has a chance of changing that. Getting people in the right frame of mind, because it still comes down, we can pull ourselves back from the precipice, pull ourselves back from the brink. And this is one of the only things, if not the only thing, I've ever seen that can do that. Because it's an idea whose time has come again. That we have the power within ourselves. And this is not a kumbaya moment by any stretch. People who know me, they know. It's like, look, I can spin some doom and gloom. We have the power inside ourselves to be everything we were supposed to be. You just have to see it. It's right there. You've been lied to your whole life, but it's a lie that you can break out of. It'll take a little while. It'll take a while to convince friends, family, and everybody around. But once we hit that, and maybe it's not a 100th monkey moment, maybe it's a million monkey moment, whatever it is. Well, that's a good shirt. Somebody should write that down. Whatever it is, we can hit it. We can change this before it's too late.
Yes.
So that's what I'm trying to pitch to people.
And also, I think that saying that we have too many people and there's not enough resources may not be entirely true, although the Georgia Guidestones sort of says differently. But it seems like that the resources are being allocated by the powers that be incorrectly. And so it appears that there's too many people because a lot of people don't have food and water and they're starving. And meanwhile, many of us in the West anyway have everything we need plus more. People are throwing out good food all the time. It's because of greed, and it's because of selfishness, and it's because of the lust for power that there are so many have-nots, which makes it appear like there's too many people. Because they just don't, they're dying off minute by minute in countries, starving to death, dehydrating because of lack of water, when, you know, I can just turn my tap on and leave it on 24 hours a day and waste water if I would want to do such a horrible thing. So we're all together. We're all as one. And maybe that will bring about a change if we can get the authority out of the picture somehow and become the authority.
If everything is reached, and don't people take this the wrong way when I say that there should be any sort of, you know, depopulation. I'm saying the way the system's set up now, it's not going to work the way it's going. If we have a different system in place, we can build something that holds way more people than this, and we can do it efficiently, and we can do it with very little suffering. And maybe that happened in the past. Maybe the older versions got to that point. And maybe that's, you know, maybe it's the ultimate goal of every one of the versions that have come before us. But I think we should strive for it. I don't think we should, you know, we should give up right away, you know, or give up at all.
Definitely. A friend of mine on Facebook, her name is Rachel, asked me to ask you a question. And he wanted to know, how do you talk about the flat earth with people? And we've kind of touched on that. How do you best explain it to people so that they can get their head around it?
You have to start with a question, which is, how do you know what you know? And that is, you don't have to talk about it with them. All you have to do is put it in their head. And that sounds sort of insidious when I put it like that. It's like, here's how you brainwash somebody. No.
Well, it's like Matt Powerland's photo or painting t-shirts that he's got out in his comedy routine on that. It's the same thing. How do you know what you know?
How do you know what you know? And that is, do you know? You put the question in their head, and that is, the world is shaped like a globe. How do you know? Do you know just because you saw it in a classroom when you were young? And if that's the case, then you move to the second stage, which is okay, because the second one's always the same, and that is because they saw the picture. You know, everyone knows. It's like, well, NASA has proof. It's like, okay, but NASA is a military wing of the United States government. What, if, aside from them, how do you know? That's the question you have to put, you know, in their heads. And that's usually enough, because that gets them going. That's get them poking around. That, and, you know, just type in flat earth on YouTube and say, or show them a link. You know, I've got several trailers, which I don't think are used that much, where I design them more of, you know, teasers, where I don't even narrate my trailers. I'm just putting out questions. John LeBon made some neat little trailers that I think I've got in one of my short playlists. It's like less than 3 minutes long, but it's some neat music, and it just asks questions, which is, you know, what about this? What questions about the space, you know, space, questions about Antarctica. If you can get people to think about these questions, even for a couple of minutes, it's stuck in their head and they're in trouble at that point. And again, it's not trouble. Look, that's just how the process. I'll pick on Joe Rogan. It's like, look, he didn't have to bring up flat earth for those last two shows, you know, this week, but he did. Which means it's in his head already. And that's how I've seen every debunker. You know, there are debunkers that are trying every week. They're, you know, how I'm debunking the flat earth, number 30. You know, it's not going anywhere. The ratings are horrible. The comments are horrible, but they keep trying. Some people, they take longer than others because they don't want to give it up. And I understand that. I wanted to hold on to the globe for so long. It was a cool model. I liked the model. It ain't the model. This is it. This is where we are. This is where we've always been. It's way more efficient, and it's an illusion. It's a trick. That's why I made Clue 12, you know, to show people, and maybe I should end kind of like on this note. It's like, look, people come back and they say, look, the whole world can't be fooled. I can't be fooled. It's like, yes, you can. In fact, it is so easy to fool us on so many levels that you got to take your ego out of it. You can be fooled by simple parlor tricks 6 days a week and twice on Sundays. With enough technology, you can be fooled by very, very big things. If you think that's a joke, I wasn't kidding when I said about Hollywood, why do you get emotional at movies? It's because you want to believe them. We naturally genetically want to believe. We want to believe that, you know, that all the things that are happening on screen are real. That's why we get emotional about it. We're genetically sucked into this thing. And if you want to break out, you can. You got a chance. It'll be a blast. Trust me on this.
It is. Flat Earth to me has been what you said. It's been a blast. And the ride, I think, is just going to continue as we learn more information and discard other information. And people come up all the time, brand new videos on YouTube. I've discovered incredible people. I try to comment on their videos whenever I can. And it's made me feel like I had a purpose and a goal more than I had before. I've always been spreading veganism and trying to, not always, ever since I became vegan anyway, and trying to spread information out there prior to veganism about conspiracies in general and letting people know the world is not what we thought it was. But guess what? The world is definitely not what I thought it was. And now I know what it is, or at least partially, that it's definitely flat, and the rest is up for debate. We're trying to figure out exactly the numbers, and there's a dome, or how deep the ground goes, and so many other aspects. And it's all exciting and new and fresh. And it's the best movie ever, and we're starring in it right now. We're so lucky that this has happened in our lifetime. This didn't happen in our grandparents' lifetime, and generations before that. They went to their grave thinking they live on a ball, and we're finding out totally different information. And it's you know, you want to just scream it, you know, from the mountaintop to people, but people are very much shut down to it. I also like Eric Dubé's 200 proofs that he came out with. I think that's a really good teaching tool to send to people or let people know about, as well as the Flat Earth Clues and a photo of painting from Math Powerland. And there's so many other people YouTube videos that you can post and send people. But the thing is, a lot of people will never watch them. And I don't understand exactly why. What differentiates me from somebody who says, oh no, I'm not watching that. That's stupid. It's not going to hurt to watch it. And I think you need to tell people just to give it a fair shot and then come back after you've watched it and let me know what you think. So the only way we're going to ever get this thing going is to kind of a grassroots sort of thing, one person at a time, kind of a tag team sort of thing, or a relay race where you're handing off the baton to somebody else and then they run as far as they can and hand it off to somebody else. And I think that we owe it to each other and the whole Flat Earth, the animals, to expose the liars for who they are. Breaking down NASA is a real big part of the whole Flat Earth thing. Let people know about the YouTube video, A Funny Thing Happened on the Way to the Moon. Let them watch that. Break down NASA right in front of their eyes. And it's kind of like when a kid finds out there's no Santa Claus, maybe they're going to cry. But, you know, the truth helps you grow up, and you probably still get some presents along the way anyway. So, Mark, what's next? Is there going to be a Flat Earth Clues number 13 coming out?
Yeah, there is. I've been told to hold on to that one for as long as I can. By people with special abilities. And so I've pretty much got it in my head. I have not written a thing down though on it yet, but I've got a good idea what's going to be. And then still working on Strange World, still helping Jonathan out with his show Perceptions, still doing interviews, of course. And
Jonathan's show is a good show, and I've listened to his very first show called Perceptions. Yeah. And you were his guest on that show, and I really enjoyed it and looking forward to more from him. And it's not about the Flat Earth at all, but although when you were the guest, the Flat Earth was
mentioned. Yeah.
And, you know, but it's just an interesting show. And you mentioned people with special abilities. I'm sure that went over some people's head when you said it, and other people are thinking, special abilities? What are you talking about? Levitation?
No, there's been a lot of people, because I am not a psychic in any way, shape, or form. I am the opposite of psychic. I you know, walk through dangerous places all the time and have no idea what's going on. But there, because of that, I think a lot of psychics are drawn to me. So I've had a whole bunch of people contact me, some more legitimate than others, but the ones that have been kind of, you know, telling me, you know, pointing me in certain directions. And I've been taking their advice in some cases, especially when it comes to clues. And they were telling me, it's like, look, you got to get the clues out because September's coming. And I go, because I was only going to do, I think, about 13 clues anyway. 13 was really the capper on that. And I knew I held on to 12 for a very long time, but we'll see. I'm working this one out, and maybe, you know, if I'm lucky, maybe I have it done another week. Probably won't wait too much longer after that. But yeah, so I am in contact with some of those people. Some people say, well, you know, that's kind of freaky. But then some of these people come from religious backgrounds. You know, they're more, not necessarily much psychics as religious prophets. And, you know, I take all comers. You know, I'm not going to judge all God's children. And, you know, because I'm start with flat earth. So how much crazier can it get?
Well, thank you for taking your time to talk with me today. I really enjoyed it. And I know that I am going to be on an upcoming episode of Your Strange World show. And hopefully we will have another opportunity to talk. Maybe when the dust settles, literally or not, after September is over, maybe we can talk after that, if you're willing and able.
Oh, I'd be happy to do it.
All right, wonderful. Maybe we'll have more interesting events to talk about at that point. Wonderful. Thank you so much for taking your time to be here today. Once again, it's Mark Sargent, and you can find his Flat Earth Clues on YouTube, and you can get the free prepper guide by emailing him at msargent23@comcast.net.
Net.
Oh.
That 23 has nothing to do with September 23rd. I swear I've had that address for 20 years.
Well, the number 23 comes up a lot, and there's even a Jim Carrey movie with it. So, yeah, very interesting number that does come up a lot. A number I have been seeing a lot for several months. I look over at my microwave, and it's, you know, 823. It's just, it's uncanny. Could be coincidence.
Could
of course,
be. Could be.
I'm not sure if I believe in coincidence at all. But anyway, Strange World, the program that you have, which is also available on your YouTube channel of the same name. And I've talked to Mark a number of times. We've Skyped back and forth and doing this show here now. And some people, when I mention on my Facebook page, my personal page, and you can friend me, by the way, Patricia Steer, S-T-E-E-R-E, in Houston, Texas. You'll see a redhead, so you'll know it's me. You can friend request me. Also on my Flat Earth and Other Hot Potatoes Facebook page. Some people have mentioned when I posted Mark was going to be my guest, oh, he's a shill. He's definitely a shill. But the thing is that I know what's going on in the world a little bit, and I don't get any qualities like that you're attempting to manipulate the Flat Earth movement. Now, I know you have viewpoints like the dome, or you feel that there's some underground aspect that's controlling the lava flow and the earth shifting when it comes to earthquakes and the plumbing, perhaps. Those things some people think are weird. But, I mean, the whole thing is weird and alien to what we have been taught. And, of course, you've seen some things in night vision that you believe might be another version of us, per se, that could come from another pod on the flat earth, another enclosed dome or part of the same one we're in, who knows. I don't think any of those characteristics that Mark is exhibiting in statements that he's made point to shillism. I think a shill would be trying to derail the whole flat earth thing. And Mark, we have about a minute left or so, and Mark, unless in that minute comes out and says, the flat earth's a lie, I my case with my statement that I don't feel that he's a shill at all. And not even one single second. And unless you're an incredible actor and should be a part of NASA acting on the ISS right now, I officially declare you shill free.
Oh, thank you. I will take that title of being shill free, because look,
say that again, because your whole broadcast there, NASA got a hold of it and sort of bleeped it out. Say that again. The feed died for a moment. Go ahead.
Oh, did it?
Yeah.
Oh, well, they're probably listening at this point.
Yeah.
Because no. The shill thing, look, it's got the label. I knew why it was put on there, you know, months ago. It's going to fade away eventually, you know. But I know the conspiracy world is naturally suspicious. I understand. I totally get it. But look, if there's no proof, if you got nobody that can come out and say, oh, yeah, here's a shill and here's why, then eventually you got to give up on it. So, you know, I've been about as transparent as I can. If anyone's, you know, driving around Seattle near Whidbey Island wants to put me on, you know. Well, the thing is, I'm on video with you right now. How much more, you know, what else do I have to do?
I get you as a real guy. And I kind of feel sometimes I don't know if nerdy is the word that you use for a woman, kind of nerdy in a way. And I see you as being akin to that, a really nice nerdy guy who came from sort of a Christian upbringing, but doesn't have sort of the Christian aspect to what you're talking about, although there is a form of creator being told in what you're saying. You're not coming out and saying everyone needs to read the Bible now or anything like that.
No.
You're not bashing Christianity or promoting any particular religion. You're pretty much saying we all are here on the flat earth together. Let's try to make this thing work. Revealing things to people in the sort of 101/for dummies way that you did with the flat earth clues, really easily swallowable bite-sized bits of information. And from flat earth clues, if that's the way you discovered flat earth first, bravo. And if it was through Eric Toubé or Matt Powerland or somebody else, there's many other routes that you could take. They're all a piece of the puzzle, and I think all people should be respected. And the thing I hope is that all the players treat each other with respect, so that we can all continue to respect them. So that's what I've got to say on it. And once again, Mark, really, I appreciate your time. Thank you for being here.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It was my pleasure.
All right. Wonderful. Well, once again, I'm Patricia Steer, and thank you for joining me. And I did not enable chat in this particular Google Hangout because I tried it and it didn't work. So once I'm done with this broadcast, I'll do some deep digging, research, see if I can make it work. That's pretty much it. Please like my Facebook page, Flat Earth and Other Hot Potatoes, and please subscribe to my channel. I'm new at this. I'm not a professional at making videos, obviously, and it's really fun for me. And I hope that you've enjoyed it, and I'm going to attempt to have other really great people in the Flat Earth world on here with me. But I also do a show every Sunday at 5 p.m. Central with Michael Lewis of Stars Our Souls, and I'm sure you're subscribed to his channel. And we'll just talk freeform about Flat Earth stuff. Mark and I have done that today, too. And like I said, Mark, I want to have you back on. And a final word on things is that you need to erase what you've been taught. We all really need to do that because it was told to you to control you. You need to start fresh and seek truth without fear. All right. Thank you very much.